20001.
You're looking at an office complex on Merritt Drive in North Dallas, Texas, which is headquarters for the Perot Group, a family business and investment firm. For the next 2 hours, we'll be talking with H. Ross Perot, the founder of United We Stand America. Here is some background information. Mr. Perot was born in Texarkana, Texas on June 27, 1930. In 1949, he entered the U.S. Naval Academy in Annapolis, Maryland, serving as a class president and battalion commander. Ross Perot graduated from the academy in 1953. He began his business career in 1957 as a salesman for IBM. 5 years later, in 1962, Mr. Perot founded Electronic Data Systems, or EDS. He sold the company to General Motors in 1984 for $2.5 billion, serving for 2 years on GM's board of directors. In 1988, the Perot Systems was founded, a computer service company in the U.S. and Europe. And in 1992, he ran as an independent presidential candidate, getting 19% of the popular vote. Ross Perot is married to the former Margot Birmingham of Greensburg, Pennsylvania. They have 5 children. Ross Perot's office is located on the 17th floor. Currently, volunteers for United We Stand America work out of a building across the street. C-SPAN's conversation with Ross Perot will begin with a tour of his office, and within the hour, we'll begin taking your phone calls.
Okay.
Okay, well, we'll get this in now. This will take about 4 to 5 days.
Ross Perot, it's almost 18 months after you first got into this business of politics. On the scale of the things you've done in your life, where would you put it at this point?
Well, I never thought of it that way. It's very, 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 very different from doing business. Business, at least in the business world I've been in, is logical and rational, and politics has very little logic and rationality to it. So that's the biggest change. It's been an interesting experience.
Are you surprised by the way this whole system works?
I now understand why it doesn't work.
Why? Why doesn't it work?
Because it's all based on games and images and not on delivering results to the American people. See, in business, you either deliver results or you go out of business. Here, it's how things look. And our organization is dedicated to how things are and how things ought to be and what kind of world our children will live in. And that's what drives us.
What do you think of the budget agreement?
It didn't do the job. The American people are willing to pay more taxes and sacrifice for their children to balance the budget and pay down the debt over a period of years. When we get back to my office, I'll show you one of my charts that shows this plan starts out with a deficit, the annual increase in the debt here. It goes down. It never gets below $200 billion a year increase in the debt, which is an incredible number. Then it takes off like a rocket in 1998. And goes back up to $400 billion in the year 2003. I'm going to show your viewers government forecasting during the Reagan years, during the Bush years, and then they'll probably just sleep under the bed tonight realizing that government forecasting is not an exact science.
Based on you and observing the situation as it happened in Washington, is it possible to really bring about a change then?
Absolutely. Because
how?
The people want it and the people own the country, and what we have to do is what we're trying to do, and millions of us are trying to do it together. We're getting organized, and we're getting organized for 94. And you're going to see a well-informed electorate in 94 that cannot be jerked around by silly little one-minute ads saying, watch my lips, no new taxes, or the Willie Horton ads, or those things that used to work. We're going to be more in a Joe Friday mode. Just the facts, ma'am.
President, at the governor's conference a couple days ago, spelled out the early structure for a health care change, plan change. What was your reaction to what he said?
I don't want to comment on health care until we've seen the detailed plan. I want to give them an opportunity to present the detailed plan. We hope it's a great plan. We'll wait. We'll analyze it. Let's go back. Let's be rational. Let's give them a chance. Let's see the plan. If it's a great plan, we will link arms with them. and march across the desert to get it done. If we feel there's a better plan, we'll make that clear.
When you hear the president talking about mandating that every employer must have health insurance, what's your reaction to that?
I go back to first base and say, everything we do interrelates. Only in America would we continue to place more and more burdens on business at a time when we desperately need a growing, expanding economy and desperately need every American at work in a good job, in a good paying job so they can pay good taxes, right? And execute a trade agreement that allows everybody to escape all these headaches, including mandated health care, and go to Mexico. You see what I mean? It all fits together. We've got to deal with it that way, and yet it's very popular inside the Beltway to continue to burden business. They're killing the small businessman. Let me say it tonight to your viewers. 80 million working Americans work in small businesses. That is a huge percentage of the total workforce. That makes the Fortune 1000 look like peanuts in terms of the number of people they employ. We cannot destroy the small business person. If we will set that small business person free, if we will get credit and capital to him, if we'll get rid of all of the burdens that General Motors carries that we drop around his neck now, we can have a tremendous growth in our economy in a short period of time if we stop shipping all the good jobs overseas.
Do you feel different standing here in your office in Dallas than you would if you were in a New York or Washington television studio?
No, not really.
How does the world look from Dallas compared to the way you think it looks from Washington?
Well, anywhere across the country, the world looks about the same to me. 2 or 3 days inside the Beltway, though, and I feel like I've been on a different planet. Because once you get in there, it's, you know, we've got to do this because of momentum. We've got to have a victory. Say, wait a minute. All that matters is to have a good plan, right? All the thing that matters is to have a victory for the American people, not the Democrats, not the Republicans. The American people don't care about momentum. They want results. So after 2 or 3 days, I come home and just wander around in shopping malls, go to Home Depot and Walmart, eat in barbecue stands. And it's kind of like coming up from a deep sea dive. You know, you have to decompress. Now, our challenge, and we can do this in the world of electronics, is try to de-beltway Washington, which is one of my long-range goals and our organization's goal, is to have everybody inside Washington in touch with the common, ordinary American citizen. We'll do it. It'll take a while.
In your book, you say that in the recent poll that you took, that 20% of the American people, or at least 20% of the people you polled,
right,
said that they've become members of United We Stand. Have you gotten those 20%?
No, we're hard at work. No, every time we have a meeting. See, I'll be on the road all weekend in New York and Pennsylvania, 7 different rallies, and we'll be talking about the fact that we have not gotten all those folks in yet. Our effectiveness is a direct function of our size. The bigger we are, the better organized we are, as long as we're constructive, as long as we keep our one filter. And that filter that everything has to go through is it good for our country? That's the only filter we talk about. We don't talk about political games ever. We talk about what's good for our country, then we all go hit the wall to do it. And we'll be hitting the wall on NAFTA. We'll be hitting the wall on the gag rule. We've got a busy fall. And if Congress is not responsive, the whole Congress is running in 94, a third of the Senate is running, we got a new song we'll start playing in our rallies this weekend. It says, I'll remember you in 94.
The Dallas Morning News this morning says you got a new book coming out.
Yes.
Labor Day. What is it?
This is on the Mexican trade agreement. I want every working American to understand that agreement. It's over 1,000 pages long. Very few members in Congress have read it, I found out. Anytime I get into a discussion with people who are for it in Congress, I say, have you read the agreement? Well, it's like reading the Bible or the Encyclopedia Britannica. No. So we wrote a 100-page book that takes the really good, meaty stuff out of the agreement and refers back to the page in the 1,000-page agreement if you want to go there. And when you read it, you won't believe anybody representing the United States of America cut that deal. It's another one-sided trade deal. But as you know better than I from being inside the Beltway, trade deals are made for diplomatic purposes. And the American working man and woman get their heads handed to them because of these bad trade deals. See, making shirts in Guatemala for 25 cents an hour, but they never decrease the price of the shirts. It's a profit game. The profits went through the roof. They got rid of all the U.S. mandates, health care, retirement, Social Security, you name it. Family leave. They got a strike breaker law pending in this country right now. If they pass it, that's another reason to go to Mexico, because when you have a strike in Mexico, all you got to do is one big U.S. auto plant did, is call the Mexican police. They came in, shot 20 people, threw the union out, cut wages 45%, put everybody back to work. Now, how can we be a part of that? That's what we're going to get in front of the American people. And the American people are going to get in front of the Congress and the Senate and make sure that they understand that the only way we can ever get our economy back in order is to have our people at work in good-paying jobs. See, I can tell you stories that will make you cry about hard-working Americans. One woman worked for 23 years in the company. They moved it to Mexico. She was 47 years old. Nobody wanted to hire her. She put herself through college, God bless her, at 47, got a bachelor's degree. She was making over $10 an hour in this manufacturing company. Now, with a bachelor's degree, she's making $5 an hour. Her husband lost his job, too, in the same company. He's making half what he used to make. They didn't do anything wrong. They did everything right. We cut a slick deal. People in Wall Street made money. The stockholders made money. The American workers were devastated, and the tax base is getting clobbered.
Why, then, do 40 of the 50 governors endorse NAFTA?
When you spend $30 billion, the biggest lobbying effort in the history of this country has been around the Mexican side of NAFTA. $30 million have been spent by the country of Mexico. You've seen those 5- and 10-page supplements run in our big newspapers. They've got lobbyists hired in every city in the country. They're giving campaign money big time. They're flying staffs to Mexico. They're flying congressmen to Mexico. They're flying governors to Mexico. Anybody that will take a free trip and a big weekend in Mexico. Now, that is so wrong and so rotten. For example, if a policeman took a package of gum at a 7-Eleven store, we'd discipline and probably fire him. And yet when Congress and Congress's staff do that sort of thing and take these big foreign junkets and let the other country pay for it, that's just a perk. Well, not in United We Stand, it's not a perk, and we're going to get rid of that sort of stuff. That's why it's popular. It has nothing to do with reality. Let me be very kind. Maybe they just don't understand business. And they believe these economist studies. We've got a little chapter in the book on the assumptions in these studies. You'll love this. Guy with a PhD assumes that everybody in our country has a job, and if they lose a job, will get a comparable job immediately. Two false assumptions. And it goes downhill from there.
Have you read the whole agreement?
My staff and I have read it, yes. I will not tell you I have read every single word of it, but we have one person who has read it all. We have teams who specialize in each part of it that have read it again and again and again and again. We've spent a great deal of time on the book.
Let me go back to the governors. You're not saying this, but let me ask you this. Is Mrs. Richards, the governor of the state, Ann Richards, for NAFTA because of campaign contributions?
No. I think you'd have to ask her. But I've listened to her, and I certainly respect her. And I respect people who are for NAFTA. We don't X you off the list. But the facts are, when I find people I respect who are for NAFTA, I try to give them information, and typically, they're just shocked. Now, I haven't done this with the governor. I haven't had the opportunity. See, she is convinced it will be good for Texas. I am a Texan. I can make a good case that Texas might make some money out of it. But I don't want Texas to benefit at the expense of the Midwest, where all the big manufacturing companies are. And when you've got the Secretary of Commerce coming down here, and his principal argument to Texans was it will require $19 billion worth of infrastructure in Texas for NAFTA, that's roads and bridges. You don't think Mexico's going to pay for those, do you? The taxpayers are going to pay for those. And I guess the theory is you get the money from other states, ship it to Texas. You follow me? But we're all one big family in the 50 states. If you want to see the most ardent NAFTA supporter drop on his knees, and let's get all the governors in the room, and I'll announce that we're going to do a pilot. And we're going to pick one state in the United States and let it have Mexico's rules for 5 years. 58 cents an hour labor, no unions. You've got absolute control over your workers. Your workers will live in a one-room shack with a dirt floor with no water, no electricity, and no plumbing. And it goes downhill from here. And we'll pilot that. Every time I bring that up, people say, Perot, you have really lost it. Every factory in the United States would be in that state. I say, I rest my case. Say, is it good for our country? We don't have a filter that says, is it good for the border states? Is it good for our country?
Share with our audience what the plan is here, because
Great.
We're going to be together for a long time, and we're going to get the audience into this fairly soon, but not for a half hour or so. We will be in the Perot headquarters here for a total of 2 hours. We've been talking probably for 10, 15 minutes, and we thought it'd be interesting for you to see the Perot Museum. What would you call this? You've got all
this
the
Ross's stuff.
Ross's stuff.
Yes. And a better way to put it, see, I've got a house full of girls, four girls and one son. And most of what you see here, Margot and the girls are not too excited about having me bring home. Now, I think it's really neat stuff, but one of my daughters, who's a real character, goes through my office and say, cluttered. So most of it's here because there's no demand to bring it home.
As soon as it'll probably take 30 minutes or so to go through this, and we'll go to the phones. We'll go into your office,
terrific,
sit down, go to the phones, and let the audience get into this. What would you say has been your plan, your pattern of how you put, what did you put in here? What was the reason for doing it?
There was no reason. There's no pattern to it at all. I am not a collector. People call me once they understand. Now, for example, I saw one of these wooden birds. And, you know, I thought, well, that's pretty. Then I heard the story of the woodcarver. This is a man named Perry Holly who was an orphan, who grew up in the Corsicana Orphans Home, who had no toys as a child, and carved all of his toys from old pieces of wood and developed this skill.
And you bought those from him?
So then I met Mr. Holly. He carved the whole scene for me. Now, as Paul Harvey would say, now here is the rest of the story. Stanley Marcus of Neiman Marcus discovered him. Stanley Marcus anointed him as the greatest wood carver living in the world. I couldn't afford Perry Holly today. I mean, each bird is worth more than the whole scene. These are the birds of Texas, and everybody from other states really doesn't pay much attention to the birds and goes straight to this grasshopper. This is a giant grasshopper, and everybody says, is there a grasshopper that large? Yes, that's a West Texas grasshopper. And then they get preoccupied. See, this is along a Texas fence, and down here, in addition to all these interesting birds, you've got frogs, you've got turtles, you've got just odds and ends. There's a little frog right there. And then here you've got some quail that are eating right here, and this quail here is going after a ladybug. So Perry Holly, in addition to being a great artist, was whimsical in putting all this interesting stuff in.
What's this over here?
Now see, everything is here for a reason. This is here with all my associates and the people who make the company go. And they do, I don't. And that's the history of my business success. This is the reminder of Perry Holly grew up with nothing and became a world-famous woodcarver. This is for anybody who ever gets discouraged. The artist who painted this gave it to me as a gift for the work on public school reform in Texas. He is paralyzed from the neck down. Now, I hope your viewers can see, it's got every shingle. Keep in mind, it's not a photograph. Look at all those little tree branches. Look at the stripes in the flag. This man painted with a brush in his teeth. He didn't give up. He took this great talent that was locked inside him, put a brush in his teeth, and learned to paint like this.
Why don't we keep on moving, or we'll never get through this.
Okay.
The flag, anything special?
Oh, yes. My son Ross, who is now Big Ross, I am Old Ross, as a little boy, was a great fan of the space program, and he had the opportunity to meet Frank Borman and a lot of other great opportunities. And when we decided to put a man on the moon, Neil Armstrong, Ross was determined to see the blast off, determined to see the landing, and it wasn't pretty getting him into Cape Canaveral because everybody said children couldn't go. Then I found that Senator Kennedy had gotten his son in, mentioned that, and they let Ross go, and he got to sit in a room with Wernher von Braun during the launch because they didn't want a child out on the grandstand, which was an incredible experience for him that really shaped his life and interest in aviation.
That's
okay,
fine.
They landed. The day they landed, I called a freshman congressman and asked him if we could get the flag that was flying over the Capitol that day for my son. He said, I'm just a freshman. I won't be able to get it, but I'll try. Nobody else asked for it. The reason this is here in the reception room is to remind everybody in marketing, ask for the order. Ask for the order. Nobody else asked for it. Here's Neil on the moon. This is one of a small number of plaques that were left on the moon, and they had some down here. And here's a great one here. This is when they were doing the Lincoln Memorial, excuse me, right over here. The competition, all the artists that competed had to make maquettes. This is the maquette that was used in the competition for the Lincoln Memorial, and the artist was saying, or the sculptor, if I win, I will carve a giant version of this.
How'd you get that?
Well, now again, see, I'm not looking for it. I'm not shopping. Some guy calls me. Then my big challenge is to determine, is this really what it's supposed to be? And I get good people from museums to help me there. But I couldn't turn that down.
When did you buy that?
Oh, probably 20 years ago.
You remember what you paid for it?
Not much. Because, no, I could look it up. But the interesting thing, here's Eisenhower's message to the troops when they landed at Normandy. And again, his challenge was to motivate hundreds of thousands of people. I have full confidence in your courage, devotion to duty, and skill in battle. We will accept nothing less than full victory. Good luck, and let us all beseech the blessing of Almighty God upon this great and noble undertaking. Ike Eisenhower.
Now, you've got
Denison, Texas, 70 miles from here.
You've got Abraham Lincoln and Dwight Eisenhower. Are those two your heroes?
No, I had a chance to get his message. See, no, certainly they're heroes of mine. Yes, excuse me. But the reason I wound up, this is no careful plan. See, we leap from here to Thomas Edison, who's another hero of mine.
Now these, I was looking at them earlier, these are actual letters?
These are handwritten notes from a man who changed the world, who gave us the electric light, whose teachers thought he was dumb. I've got them right here to all my associates saying, you may be a little different, you may be a character, maybe you don't fit and blend in, but neither did he. And he changed the world.
Where'd you get the letters?
Well, they came up for auction. And someone called and says, you're not going to believe it, but we got some letters from Thomas Edison. So again, we checked, and this was one of the major auction houses, and we checked their authenticity. But here's one of my favorites. He says, how many assistants have you? I want each man to come to the laboratory one at a time and answer a questionnaire. It is essential that I know what kind of men are employed. And here's my second favorite. He said, I raised hell about men on the tables loafing. They had taken on a great number of men and hadn't let them off. And he goes on in here and says, don't hire too many men. Here, he's talking like an aeronautical engineer, saying they're building a streetcar that he's going to power with electricity. And he's saying, making it heavier doesn't make it stronger. Let's design it like an airplane way back then. Here, this typed letter, he has the home computer, what became the Apple computer, in his head. But this is when they didn't even have vacuum tubes. All he had was relays and switches. He calls it the home teaching machine, 1924.
Back here, there are several things, and if we don't keep moving, we're never going to get through
okay.
it all.
Colonel Simons, who led our rescue for our men who were imprisoned in Iran, a great guy. I've got a lot of his mementos in my office. We'll talk more about him. But probably the most interesting man, one of the smartest men I ever met, one of the most unconventional men I ever met, the greatest risk taker I have ever known, and yet a man who would not take any risk he didn't have to take.
Is this the Magna Carta?
The Magna Carta that we bought is on loan to the National Archives. This is the first book ever printed in gold. It is the Magna Carta. It was printed in 1816 for King George IV.
What was the Magna Carta?
The Magna Carta gave the Englishmen their freedom. There were 16 copies. We found one that could leave Great Britain. It was owned by the family of the man who led the charge of the Light Brigade. They lived in an old, old house. They had had it since it was written on animal skin. It took us about a year to get it worked out, and it's now at the National Archives.
How long have you owned it?
Oh, 7 or 8 years.
Was that expensive?
Yeah, $1.5 million. I remember that one. But but it's a bargain compared to what it's worth.
What about the big painting?
Well, this came on the market about 4 years ago. Norman Rockwell painted it. This is the young Lincoln. I love it because here is a young man cutting wood. This is America. This is the American dream. But he is reading for the law. And he raised himself up by his bootstraps, became a lawyer, and became our president. And the most interesting thing about this, nobody sees it coming back to my office, and when they walk out, it blows them away just because of the size of it.
How long have you had that
great
design?
Great painting. About 5 years, I think.
Norman Rockwell, there are others in here.
No, I love, see, I sold Saturday Evening Post as a boy. All these things are on the cover.
Before we go to the others, let's go over, this is Winston Churchill.
That's Winston Churchill, that's Prince Charles. And
what was the Winston Churchill Award?
That was given to me in 1985, I believe, and Prince Charles gave it to me, and that's just a nice thing.
What does it mean to you?
Well, it was very kind of him to give it to me. That's.
You quote Winston Churchill a couple of times
yes.
in your books.
Yes.
Why?
Because I admire him.
What do you admire about him?
That I think he's one of the greatest men of the 20th century. He saved Europe in World War II. They had lost the war except for Churchill, and he gave the people the courage to stay. I wish we had 4 hours. I could tell you beautiful. Well, I'll tell you one. He was down in the ruins right after an air raid. where the people's homes were devastated, this is the prime minister. He was right down there with the people, and he was crying. And an old British lady said to another one, "He cares." I think that says it all. He cares. And that gave him his leadership skills. These were done by Norman Rockwell in World War II at the request of President Roosevelt, the four freedoms. Freedom of speech. I love the faces. This is the America I grew up in. Hard-lined faces of people who worked outdoors. Freedom of worship. I love the old lady's face. I love her hands. I love her little wedding ring there. Look at the character in these faces. Freedom from fear, which was very important to communicate during the war, and freedom from want, the four freedoms.
Did you ever meet Norman Rockwell?
Yes, I had the privilege of meeting him, and my dream was that he would do a painting of my son while he was a little boy. He agreed to do it, had a stroke, and couldn't finish it. But we had the privilege of meeting him.
Where'd you meet him?
Up in his studio.
In Massachusetts?
Yes. Great, great person.
We've seen Abraham Lincoln, Dwight Eisenhower, Abraham Lincoln again,
Simons,
and Norman Rockwell. Are we getting a pattern here of the kind of people you like?
No, let's go to Raoul Wallenberg.
Who was Raoul Wallenberg?
Everyone must know who he was. This is a Swedish diplomat from a very wealthy family in Sweden who was educated in college in the United States in Michigan, was a diplomat during World War II, saved 100,000 Jews by giving them Swedish passports, was taken by the Russians at the end of the war, and never returned, was seen in Russia in the late 80s. And one of my dreams before I turn out the lights is that we will recover Raoul Wallenberg as a very old man, or his remains, and return him to Sweden. He is a hero.
This is the Raoul Wallenberg Award presented to Ross Perot by whom?
By the Raoul Wallenberg Society.
For what? What reason?
I think we'd have to ask Sam, but I was the first recipient in the United States, and it was, I think, for the rescue of our people from Iran.
Okay, we've got
cameras. Now, this one I love. This is the Aiken Bible. It's the only Bible ever authorized by Congress in the United States. Bibles in English had to come from England before the war, the Revolution. Then they ran out of Bibles during the Revolution, and when our troops were fighting barefooted, the Congress felt that we had to have Bibles for our children in school, and they authorized this Bible. These were the men who framed the Constitution in many cases.
Where'd you get it?
Again, it came on the market. I did not know there was such a thing. I heard about it. I read about it. I had the people down in Austin at the University of Texas Library check it out. It was authentic, and I bought it.
When did you buy it?
Probably 15 years ago.
Expensive?
Not too, for what it is, because it's so unique. No, that wasn't that expensive.
Over here, and we've got a camera in the way. It might take us a little bit to get the camera moved aside, is Theodore Roosevelt. Where did you get that?
He's been here probably for nearly 20 years. I found this in New York. This was done by the man who did Mount Rushmore, Borland, and thousands of people with battlefield experience. I asked for volunteers to help go get these people out. I hoped somebody would volunteer. Every man I asked volunteered. Colonel Simons, who I had known from the Santé raid, called him at 2 in the morning, asked him if he would help us. He said, "I'll be there first thing in the morning." He was retired. He didn't have to do this.
What was the Santé raid?
Santé raid was when they the effort to rescue prisoners of war 20 miles outside Hanoi, 350 miles behind enemy lines. It was a high-risk mission. This is Simons at his best. He went in. Unfortunately, the camp was empty. They had a heck of a fight on the ground. He got all of his men out. He had one broken ankle. Do the impossible, have no casualties. That's why I called him.
John Paul Jones.
Well, John Paul Jones is the father of the American Navy. I'm a sailor, Naval Academy graduate. But he is here in a prominent place in my business office because he became a hero, not because of anything he did. He was sinking. John Paul Jones's ship was sinking. The British had him. He lashed himself to the British ship right here. One enlisted man, who you can barely see right up here, had walked out on the yardarm and dropped a basket of hand grenades on the British ship. Jones didn't order him to do it. One enlisted man, using his head, figured out what to do, did it. Jones's ship sank. They sailed home to victory on the British ship, put the fire out, and Jones became the father of the American Navy and a hero, thanks to one enlisted man. Now, that's the story of my business career.
Where'd you get the art?
Well, a Canadian painter painted a series of 12 of these scenes for a movie about John Paul Jones. And after the movie, they were up for sale. So I got them as a set.
We've got another hallway here, and then we're going to go try to get into the office. And we've, for those that just joined us, we're in Dallas with Ross Perot in his office. And what'd you call this? Ross's
stuff.
Stuff.
Yeah.
And we're going to go to his main office and take your calls in just a moment. What's this?
Well, if I could keep one tangible possession and had to give everything else up, this is what I'd keep. This is signed by all the men who were prisoners of war in Hanoi and in Vietnam 5 years after they came home. And basically, down here it says it all. Thanks for all the things that we did there to change their treatment. And the fact that 5 years later they cared enough to fly this thing all over the country, get it signed, and give it to me means a lot.
Is this John McCain's signature?
Yes.
The senator?
Yes.
Any other well-known
every
people
one of
in there?
Them. Every one of them, sure. You had all of the senators, we've got congressmen who are up there now, and we've got former senators who are up there. And I just, it'll take me forever to find their names, but they're all there, every one of them.
Who painted this?
Well, Maxine McCaffrey, who was a great Air Force artist, painted it. And this ties in. She painted this painting. This is the official Air Force picture of the POW. And this was given to me by the Air Force families. This is one of the great pictures. The dads took it harder than anyone else. Look at this man's expression. That made everything we did worthwhile. Just to see him able to hug his son again when he came home. This is one of my favorites. This was on the cover of Newsweek, Paul and Phyllis Galani. This is their son, Ross Galani. There's several of the children of the POWs named their sons after me, which is probably a heck of a burden for them, but I appreciate it. And if I could keep two possessions, I'd keep the flag here. This long handwritten letter is from an enlisted man in Vietnam. He sent it to me, I believe, in 1988. His friend, Dale DeWolf, was 19 years old when he was killed. He had this flag on his flak jacket. This man had kept this all this time, Michael Feloza, and wrote me and says, here, keep this for me. And so this is one I treasure. Now, Maxine did, this is an 8-foot painting at the Air Force Academy of Lance Sijon, the first Medal of Honor winner, recipient from the Air Force. These are her original sketches. She was dying of cancer, and one day I got all of these in the mail with these really sweet notes from Maxine saying, gee, I want you to have these. These are things from the heart, Brian. That's the reason they mean so much.
Down here at the very end is a replica of the statue in Washington.
Yes,
and,
on the Vietnam Memorial.
So we can see
See, I funded the design of the Vietnam Memorial. Then all of the people who survived were angry because the wall did not mention them, only the dead. We had an 18-month brutal battle to get the three men on patrol and the flag, but it's there. Now, it's not pretty, and I mean the scars are all over the place because it was the art community got into it and what have you. My premise was very simple. A memorial is to honor the people, and the art is secondary, and it's there. Now, this is a parade in July for the people from Desert Storm. It looks like it's snowing. That's confetti. Sweet story here. I asked all the Vietnam veterans, we had 8 states, to march in a parade. They were angry because they'd never been thanked, didn't want to do it, and I finally said, okay, just do it for me. And they did, and I appreciate it. Now, the Desert Storm guys came in town. I said, guys, you set the sequence. They said, put them in front of us. They fought for many, many years. We fought for 100 hours. Then the generals came in town and said, put us between the two groups. We fought with both groups.
Perot, 1996, from SEAL Team 4.
Yeah.
Are they talking about running for...
No.
What's 1996?
Oh, hell, I don't know. But these SEALs, the SEAL Team, see, I've been close to the SEALs for a long time, and... they have some guys that get hurt pretty badly, and we're close friends. This was fun here. After the Libyan raid, for 6 months, the Navy ships couldn't go into port. Navy called me and said, we've got to get a USO show over there. The USO called me and said, we don't have any money, et cetera, et cetera. And will you help us? And I said, yes. But then nobody could come up with a show. I watched television the night I talked to them, and the Miss USA contest was on. And I realized, this is the show. I called the girls the next morning. They all went to the Mediterranean. I almost never got them home. These guys, now, when you get sailors at sea to put on white uniforms and say, TKS, thanks, HRP, they enjoyed the show. I don't know, I've got a whole hall up here.
So the audience can see, you've got sailors here that says, TKS, thanks to HRP, H. Ross.
These guys were ready to see some good-looking girls. These girls were so terrific. They were surfacing nuclear submarines at night and taking small groups of them on board, and then they'd go down for the show and then bring them back up. No, literally, I had to get Miss USA back so she could compete for Miss Universe. We almost lost her there.
The David Sarnoff Award, the China-Burma-India Veterans Association, Americana,
no, these Americanism just, Award. Yeah, these are mainly just things from the guys in the service. Here's one I love, the Bataan people survivors. And that's from the POW. Here's a letter that'll break your heart. This is from a mother who lost a son in Desert Storm.
It's July 23rd, 1991. We were looking at it earlier.
No, God bless her. And this brings war down to me. Here's a great young man who lost his leg, made it through Desert Storm, lost his leg trying to protect the Kurds, but he is now a tactical police officer in Arizona and has broken his artificial leg twice playing rugby. So he marches forward in life. This great young man here was in Bethesda, Bill Connors from Boston. The night Panama went down, his team had to go. He went AWOL from the hospital, had the perfect ticket not to go. And was killed in Panama, and just a wonderful young man, chemical engineer.
Down here you've got the American Legion National Commander's Award. What was that for?
The POW effort.
And the Air Force Sergeant Association Award. How come?
Now, see, I love those. The Air Force Sergeant, you say, now, would you rather have an award from the White House or the Air Force Sergeants? The Air Force Sergeants, that's from the heart.
H. Ross Perot, thank you for your support during the Patrick Henry Dinner. Death waits in the dark, night stalkers. What is that?
We had all the heroes of the, they wanted to give me the Patrick Henry Award. I was to be the first recipient. I said, I will only accept it for the men who stood at the gate for 45 years in the Cold War. I said, they deserve it, I don't. And I want to buy all the tables that night, and I'm going to have a cross-section of the Cold War heroes. We had the darndest collection of guys you ever saw there that night. And we had a great time. And God bless them all. Many of them had never been thanked. They got thanked that night, big time. President Bush came and made a beautiful speech thanking them, and it meant a lot to them.
Let's get on in here. Well, I want to remind the audience again that they can call you in just a few minutes.
Okay.
As soon as we, this is, now if people were coming to see you in your office, this is where they come.
Now we're in here. Now, these are the returning veterans from World War II. This is the Marine. This is my favorite. This is the story of America. An ordinary man, a mechanic. See up here, he was a garage man. A hero in World War II. He's back now from the war. Tomorrow he'll be fixing cars again. And this is a story of ordinary people who do extraordinary things, then come back home.
Another Rockwell.
That's an original painting.
Where'd you buy that?
I bought that one from an art dealer in New York. Here's the homecoming Army Air Corps fellow. Here is the homecoming sailor. Now, the Marines love this one. They say that's what he did all during the war. So I take a lot of heat on that. Here is my equal favorite, my two favorite Norman Rockwells. Here is the American dream. You say, what is United We Stand all about? Here is what United We Stand is all about. This is each generation working and sacrificing to give the next generation a better life, not spending $4 trillion of the next generation's money. Yes. See, the father's hopes and dreams are wrapped up in the son who is going off to college. He never dreamed he couldn't get there, but he wanted to make sure his son got there.
Is that an original?
No, I couldn't buy the original. That's a copy. This is the Iwo Jima Memorial Minotaur. Now, again, these are things, if I could keep three things, I'd probably keep this. This is from the sailors on a new frigate, the Arleigh Burke, 31-knot Burke. The first time they got up to 31 knots, this flag was flying. The sailors took it down, mounted it, gave it to me, and that's one I'll keep forever. That's from the enlisted guys.
How about this? This right here.
That's to remind everybody that comes into my office with an idea to fight for it.
Let's read it. Every good and excellent thing stands moment by moment on the razor's edge of danger and must be fought for. What is it? Who said it?
I'm embarrassed. It's not original. I'm embarrassed. I don't know who said it, but all of my business success is because of the great ideas of other people, most of them too young and too inexperienced. So as they walk in the door, if you're all fired up about something, and particularly if you're an engineer and you can't express yourself too well, you know, hang in there. Now, My challenge is to interpret what the guy says, and we've been pretty good at that over the years. But if you go case by case on the big successes, there were other people's ideas, a disproportionate number from young people that shouldn't have had an idea that good, but did.
How long have you been in this office?
Since 1986. Now, if here is one I would keep, too. This is the shoe off my first horse, Patsy, when I was a little boy. And that's my good luck charm there. Now, the first thing this young person who's just read the sign sees when he comes in here is this. This is the end of the trail. Earl Frazier did this when he was 21. He did the Navy Cross, the Indian Head Nickel. He did a whole series of wonderful things. The greatest thing he ever did in his life, he did when he was 21.
And when did you get that?
Oh, that's 20 years ago. Now, all my cowboy stuff goes back to my boyhood. See, I rode horses every day. I broke horses. I rode in rodeos. I did trick and fancy roping. And I bought one Remington. Then the word got around that I would buy a Remington, and now I got a whole bunch of Remingtons. But I love them.
You know, I think it would be interesting for the audience to see the paintings. They're a lot more attractive than some of the other things.
I understand.
Is it all right?
Let's go to America's most famous painting, The Spirit of 76. There it is. And that, again, I love because it's the story of ordinary Americans who had no right to be able to make our country free from Great Britain. And there they are. They did it. This was the most famous event of the centennial. It was painted when the country was 100 years old. He painted five. This is the one that was in the White House, was on the Freedom Train. The stamps were made from it. And in 1977, the company that owned it just put it on the market. They thought the big celebration was over. And I was delighted to be able to buy it. This is the George Washington on the dollar bill, the Gilbert Stuart. I bought it from the Biddle family in Philadelphia. They bought it from Gilbert Stuart and had it for about 200 years. Now, when you realize that painting is 200 years old and you look at how fresh and delicate, look at the hair, look at the pink around the cheeks and what have you, that thing is really in good shape for 200 years old.
How much is that worth today?
I don't know. But I'll tell you this, they sold it a year too early. It went on the market. They tried to sell it. I said, no, that's too much. They kept coming back to me. That's the same way with the Magna Carta. The Magna Carta went down over time. I grew up trading horses. You have to say, if you want it, you have to say you don't. Start. To make a long story short, I finally said, well, it's worth this to me, and if you can't get more than that, I'll buy it. But he was trying to sell it in 1975. I could have quadrupled my money in 1976. Everybody wanted it. I loaned it to people, but I didn't want to sell it because I love it.
Now, to the left of that is one of your daughters?
Oh, yes. This is Carolyn. And over to the right is Nancy. And my deal with my daughters is after they get married, they give me a painting.
Hold on just a second. Let's make sure the audience can see who Carolyn is.
Carolyn, who's my third oldest daughter, who's now married. This is Nancy, my oldest daughter, who's married. Nancy has two children, has one on the way. Carolyn has not had time yet, but I'm sure she'll have a big family. Now, Suzanne, all the way over on the right in the wedding dress, that's my protest picture because I don't have an oil painting from Suzanne yet. She has one child and another on the way. They're all wonderful. And to everybody listening, I've lived across the economic spectrum. And, I know what it is not to have any money, and I have more than my share now. But the money is the least important part of the whole thing. Your family is so much, things don't mean much. But to have five children, too good to be true, to have the world's greatest wife. Now, here's Margot right over here. Margot, nothing better could have happened to any man than to be able to marry Margot. She is the perfect wife, the perfect mother, has no interest in things or money, and Margot could do anything she wanted to and spends most of her time working on Salvation Army projects. And she reared five too good to be true children. And here's my one son. This is Big Ross. I'm Old Ross. He's shown there. He's just landed. He's the first man to have flown a helicopter around the world. He was honored by the Air and Space Museum. He's the youngest man ever honored by the Air and Space Museum. His helicopter's there. Then he went into the Air Force, became a fighter pilot. And right here somewhere. Here's the helicopter. See, he was too young to realize you couldn't do this. This thing is not designed to fly the Pacific. 16 hours over the Pacific, the last 3 hours, all the calculations showed he would go in the water. The wind turned around and blew him into Shimya, and he landed with 10 minutes of fuel. So then he couldn't get it out of his system, so he became a fighter pilot. And here he is as an Air Force fighter pilot. Had a great adventure. Got out of the Air Force, settled down, had three children. I thought, this is it. And then last summer, had a chance to fly the MiG-29. No simulator time, no training. They just pointed the dials out to him and let him fly it. And you know how fighter pilots are. He had to do it. Well, the good news is he took off the end of the runway and put it on his tail, went to 70,000 feet, went into a spin, and had a great ride, and got down safely. And I hope that's his last great aerial adventure. And he will be settled down as a father now.
It's time for us to turn this show over to our callers.
Terrific.
What we're going to do is just take a brief break here, and we'll come back and get our plugs in and all that stuff so we can hear the callers, and we'll continue from Dallas with Ross Perot in a couple minutes.
C-SPAN's conversation with Ross Perot continues. And in just a moment, Mr. Perot will begin taking your phone calls. But while we're waiting to begin our call-in segment, here's some background information. United We Stand America was founded January 11, 1993. 75,000 people joined the organization in its first 24 hours. Ross Perot's first book, United We Stand, was on the New York Times bestseller list for 15 weeks. Mr. Perot's second book, entitled Not for Sale at Any Price, was on the New York Times bestseller list for 12 weeks. Combined, more than 1.5 million copies of the books have been sold. Ross Perot's new book on the proposed North American Free Trade Agreement, NAFTA, will be released on Labor Day. Since February 1993, Ross Perot has attended 69 rallies in 31 states. And this final note, that 2.5 million people have signed Mr. Perot's petition, which calls for more cuts in federal spending before additional taxes are raised.
Ross Perot, back in your office. Let's go back to what we were talking about before we started the tour. When you were on Meet the Press, I think it was Dave Broder asked you about specifics when it came down to this whole business of Medicare and Medicaid, the $141 billion cuts in the five-year plan that you had. And you said, if you'd asked me, I would have brought the plan, and we're here to ask you whether you have the plan.
Well, we're in my office, so I do have the plan. Interestingly enough, I called before I went and asked them if they wanted me to bring anything like that, and nobody gave a single issue. But you know how the game's played in Washington. Now, in contrast, see, I'm required to give a level of detail nobody has ever asked the president to give, but I'll be glad to do it. But I find that interesting. Now, I'm afraid I'm going to have to stand up a minute, which I can't really do. Could someone hand me those charts right back there?
Sure, I will.
Pile of charts. Can you stand up?
I think I can.
Okay. All right. Now, here we go. Charts are us. Health care ought to grow like this bottom line right here out through 1998. That assumes that you just keep adding people to health care and it's normal growth. But all the forecasters say it will still have runaway growth that far exceeds any number it should exceed. So we said, let's be cautious and split it right down the middle. That's where the $141 billion came from. Now then, say, well, is it realistic to stop runaway growth or at least cut it in half? That was what we set out to do. Then, let's just take a look. We spend, these are 1990 numbers because that's the latest I could get on these countries. Our country is now up to 14% of its gross domestic product is spent on health care. Canada spends 9.3%, France spends 8.8%, Germany, who everybody feels is the model that does the best job, only spends 8%. Say, well, that's interesting. Here we are, look like we have runaway spending here compared to the rest of the world, and their plans, like we are 23rd in infant mortality and all these other bad news things you know about in terms of our health care in our country, and yet we're spending more than anybody else in the world. So it is possible to save some money. So then we said, well, let's see. If we went to the Canadian model, that would cut $145 billion. If we went to the French model, that's $170. Germany would be $207, so on and so. So as you can see, our $140 looks fairly reasonable. Then finally, we get down to the details where the devil always is, and there it is, broken all the way down, category by category, in terms of where the savings are, to $141 billion.
All right, let me stop you.
Let me finish, please.
Sure.
Have you ever seen anything like this come out of the White House on their health care savings, which every premise they make is massive savings in health care, which nobody ever asked them to account for? Now, we've broken it down by minor categories here in terms of where it came from over a five-year period.
Let me ask you how you cut that, though. I mean, in other words, under hospital care,
by
Medicare?
By going through each of these things in great detail and figuring out what is a super conservative number that could be cut.
Are you saying you're not going to pay that much for hospitalization?
No, wait a minute. See, no.
Explain how this works.
You've got to go back to runaway spending. Keep in mind, if we just let it grow as the need for health care and the number of recipients of health care grew, we'd be down here. But instead, we have runaway spending on health care in our country. So you compare it to the rest of the world, these numbers don't make sense. So then you go down in detail, which we've done on this last page, category by category. And then obviously there are a lot of worksheets behind this. That's down to a level of detail that nobody else has ever presented on anything in government.
But basically what you're saying, let's look at the hospital care, that you're going to spend $75 billion less in five years. In hospital care.
Yes.
Does that mean people will get less care?
No. I mean, we'll just cut out a lot of the waste. There is gross waste in these programs, or you couldn't have this runaway spending. If you had a population increase for health care that required this level of spending, fine. This is delivering the same level of service to an ever-increasing number of people. It should be here. But for some reason, it runs up here. That's because the program's out of control. It's poorly managed.
Somebody's going to get less money, though, and I assume the hospitals?
To ever balance our budget, a lot of people are going to have to get less money. No, let's take it right down the line. Well, no, it's...
Got one more. Come back.
Excuse me. I'm sorry.
You want the detail?
It's a whole list. Oh, yeah, the detail list here. I mean, I'm reading upside down. There's hospitals, physicians, dental services, professional services, home health care, drugs, and so on and so on. We broke it down into every major category.
You have other charts there?
On different subjects.
When it comes to the health care, when we started this whole discussion earlier, you said you were going to wait till the president gives details on what your position is. From looking
at... You mean on the new health care plan?
On the new health care plan.
Yes. I want to wait and see what the plan is. It may be a great plan. Let's wait and see.
I didn't ask you this earlier, should everybody in this country have health care?
One way or another, you have to have access to health care. We have giant charity hospital operations now that take care of the poorer people. We have Medicaid for the extremely poor people now. Very few people are denied health care. In these charity hospitals, some of these people are getting incredible medical attention from the people who teach in the medical schools. So I think as you move away from what we have now, you need to be very careful to replace it with something as good or better. And the big challenge when you add 30 million people, the thing that concerns me at a distance from this whole process, So when you add 30 million people, it's hard to save money.
Time to go to the phones for our special guest here in Dallas this evening, Ross Perot. The numbers will be on your screen. Go ahead and begin dialing now, 202-628-2525 or 202-783-2727. Remember our 30-day policy. If you've called us within the last month, hold off and let others participate. And we'll take calls till the top of the hour. 1996, are your volunteers asking you to run for president?
Never discuss it. Never had a single discussion about it. We're focused on solving the country's problems now. We are concerned about our country. We're not concerned about a person running for office.
When it comes to NAFTA, how much effort are you going to put into trying to stop it once Labor Day comes around and your book is published?
We want to make sure that every American voter understands it. And then if the American people want it, fine. But I want them to make that decision based on facts, not on the propaganda coming out through the $30 million lobbying campaign, because they do not present the facts.
How would you rate the president's first 6-7 months?
I think it would be disrespectful to rate a president's performance. I wouldn't do that.
When it comes to the press and the way they're treating it at this point in this process, what's your reaction?
That's their prerogative to treat me any way they want to. I know what I'm trying to do. I have again and again and again said openly that I have no personal goals. I do have goals for my country. I am deeply concerned about the country our children will live in. I want to make sure that they are limited only by their ability to have great dreams and go out and make those dreams come true. That's what we're all about. Now, I understand in a cynical, skeptical world, nobody wants to believe anything. It sounds like something from the Boy Scout manual. I just say stick around a few years and watch. Meantime, we'll take all the heat. It's just like mosquitoes at a big picnic. Don't let it run the picnic.
Will you tell us how many members you've got in United We Stand?
No, we have a lot, but we haven't announced the number yet.
Do you ever intend to announce the number?
Sure.
Can you tell us how much money you've raised?
No, that would tell you how many members we have.
Can you tell me how much money you've continued to spend on this whole effort?
I've spent a great deal, and I've done it at the request of the members and the volunteers, and I can't think of a better use of the money. I've been richly blessed in terms of my parents, which we haven't had a chance to talk about. No child ever had better parents than I do. All their pictures and all their mementos and what have you are here in this office and mean a great deal to me. No young man could have married a finer wife or had greater children. I've had more than my share of business success. And if anybody ought to have to put up with all this, it's me. And I'm certainly willing to do it as long as the American people want me to. And if they don't want me to, I'll be happy to go back to a normal life. But right now, we have a job that needs to be done. They've asked me to do it, and I'm doing it.
First call for this session with Ross Perot is from New Britain, Connecticut. Go ahead, please. You're on the air.
Yes. I was very moved by the picture you had of a father looking at his son and sacrificing all his life so that that son could be somebody someday.
Right.
I think the whole system in this country has switched upside down.
Now, you're right.
That whole system, everybody has become entitled. Everybody, and old folk have become entitled. The poor folks have become entitled. Everybody has become entitled. And when they become entitled, like the story goes, a person got admitted to the hospital, and his bill was $275,000, and he didn't know who paid it even. whereas when his false teeth, they were bothering him. So a dentist is called in, and he says, my teeth are hurting. And he says, dentist says, look, I have to have your teeth, replaced. It's going to cost you $150. He says, look, I don't want to spend $150. And a dentist goes down and tries to look downstairs, and the government has spent $275,000 already. I think there is a need for this breaking this channel of that everybody is entitled and there is a big government out there. Government is just a money passer. It just passes money from one person to the other.
All right, New Britain, thanks. Any reaction?
Oh, absolutely. I think you're right on the money. See, strong, tough, self-reliant people built this country. People made enormous sacrifices to come here so that they could be free, so that they could practice the religion of their choice, the two basic reasons people came to our country. For our country to continue to succeed, it must rest on a strong moral, ethical base where every individual takes full responsibility for his or her own actions. Now then we will all have always have people who are so unfortunate or so poor that we need to help them. And that goes back to the poem I was taught as a child in the Texas schools. Help the man who is down today, give him a lift in his sorrow. Life has a very strange way. No one knows what may happen tomorrow. But none of us are entitled that can take care of ourselves. We all need to be working. We all need to be saving money. We all need to be looking after our families. And we all need to be putting something away for a rainy day so that we can take care of ourselves. And we ought to reach out and help other people every time we see them in need. We were taught that by our parents. We were taught that at our places of worship. We were taught that in scouting. And that vaccination should have taken after all those efforts.
Atlanta, Georgia, you're next.
Good evening, Mr. Pro. You have a lovely office.
Thank you.
I'm a hospital executive here in Atlanta, and I know your company does a great deal of business with healthcare organizations, and so I'm sure you're going to be capable of answering this question in detail. I'm curious as to where you will get the $75 billion over 5 years from hospital efficiency savings. And I'll hang up and let you answer that question.
Well, again, if I had my hospital charts here, I could get that for you. I can't do it out of my head. It's too complex. But as you know, as a hospital executive, you've got layer on layer of bureaucracy that has been imposed on you by the federal government in these federal programs. And if we just streamline the processing of all of the administrative functions in a hospital across the country and got that back under control the way it used to be, you could get a huge amount of it right there. Now, then you have the tremendous markup on drugs such as aspirin. Aspirin out of a bottle doesn't cost much. Aspirin delivered to your hospital room can cost you a lot. And it just goes on and on and on and on. We've got some really bad practices that have come into medicine as a result of the federal health programs. For example, in the early days of Medicare, it was appalling. A guy'd go in for appendectomy and the bill coming out, he had hearing aids, artificial limbs, every other thing. And you finally had to build computer programs to make sure that the charges were relevant to the procedure that the patient had. Now, these are things that creep into programs where taxpayer money is involved and nobody is watching the cash register. And we have let that run for years, and we've got to go back and streamline it and get it under control. One of the highest paid executives in this country last year was a hospital executive. That kind of confuses the American people. That confuses me.
Sacramento, go ahead, please.
Ross, this is Ron McIntyre from Sacramento, California.
Yes, sir.
Are you still going to keep track of the Clinton administration and on what the taxes are doing to us in this country? And do you agree that taxes are what we actually need?
Well, the American people, and I've spent a lot of time on this, are more than willing to sacrifice to balance the budget and pay down the debt over a period of years. They are absolutely unwilling to be conned and manipulated again. Now, let me give you an example of what I mean. During President Reagan's first 4 years, these blue bars are what he said the debt, increase in the debt would be when he took office, and would be at a balanced budget on his fourth year. In fact, the red bars are what happened. There's no correlation at all. Now, my point is, I've said publicly, the government doesn't keep books, because if you kept books, you couldn't be this far off in your forecast. I've said publicly, it's like flying blind at night, supersonic, on the deck in the mountains, in the fog with no instruments, the way we run our government and spend the taxpayers' money. Now, let's not just focus on the Reagan administration. Here are the first 4 years of George Bush's administration. Here, the blue is what he said the deficit would be. See, it's going to disappear again on you. And instead, it went through the roof. Now then, after hearing Watch My Lips, No New Taxes, we got to the Tax and Budget Summit, and they said, if you will pay more taxes, we will get the debt down to only increasing $29 billion a year in 1995. I've got to show you both these charts at once. In fact, instead of this happening, this is what happened. We had $284 billion in 1995 increase in the debt, not 29. So don't pay a whole lot of attention to forecasts, because they're always overly optimistic. But having said that, here is the forecast based on the new plan that was just passed by one big vote after deals were made that were disgusting. Now, I would like to see this country where each congressman and senator votes the will of his constituents and votes his or her conscience and does not get leveraged and threatened and beat up in closets to vote, quote, the right way. Well, we got it by one vote this time, because you saw what happened close up, and it wasn't pretty. But if everything goes on schedule, which it never has, we'll get down to $200 billion increase in the debt in 1998. And the thing, all the charts they've been showing you stop right there. The thing they don't show you is this thing takes off like a rocket and goes back up to $400 billion. This is the new plan. Number one, it's not good for our country. Number two, it's not good politics. Number three, I don't know why they did it. They said it's the best they can do now. But now let's hope for the best. They're all saying they're going to have a spending cut summit when they come back from vacation. That's doing it the wrong way. That's building a car with no engine and then saying, oops, let's build an engine when we come back. Nobody wants that car. But better that than nothing. If we get a real spending cut summit, we can get some of this under control. But right now, you have gotten another situation where they've raised your taxes, they don't balance the budget, they don't pay down the debt, they're not leaving the country in good shape for our children. So I've said again and again, it's like building a bridge halfway across the river. You can't use it.
Washington, D.C., you're next.
Yes, Mr. Perot, this is Doug Prince.
Yes, sir.
I have a tremendous amount of respect for you, and I voted for you in the last election. My friends have a very big concern, and they're calling you demagogic, and they feel that you're potentially a power monger. How would you dispel those fears? That's the first part of my question. The second part, I want you to wax philosophical about our educational system, and that is that education is supposed to equal success in the society. Success is then measured in dollars. And yet my sister and I, who are both, actually she's a pediatrician, I'm training to become a physician, are spending 12 years of our life to try to become a surgeon, and then being paid $50,000 to $100,000, being taxed to death, while we have to pay $500,000 insurance tail at the end of our lives. Can you give me some feeling about how you feel about both those things, because they're extremely important to me? I will continue supporting you, sir, because I feel just like you feel the heroes in your hallways as you walk through. I feel that way about you, because I feel you're our country's only hope at this point. So I wish you well, sir.
Well, this demagogic thing, you have to understand, you get a new buzzword after you've been around this silly game for a while. You get a new buzzword out of Washington every few weeks. If you get down in the polls, they leave you alone. If you're up in the polls, they have to take you out. It's interesting. See, I was one human being until I got into public life for 62 years of my life. Then suddenly they have to recast you if the American people are fascinated with you. I just ask the American people to look at me and make their own conclusion and not be influenced by what the image shapers are trying to create. If you think I'm a demagogue, you shouldn't have anything to do with me. It's that simple. Now, let's go to the big question you asked. See, a doctor gives years to become a doctor. He gives years in public service as a resident, as an intern, working unbelievable hours, 80, 90 hours a week, as you well know. And he is giving to the poor. Now, the thing that upset me the most in hearing about the interim steps in the health care plan is that they were going to regulate the pay that doctors received. Now, here is my response to America on that. I suggest that if we're going to start regulating people's pay, that we create a priority on a social scale and pay the people who contribute the most socially to our country the most money. Now, doctors are going to come out way high on that. Teachers are going to come out way high on that. I just find it obscene that we would think about regulating a doctor's pay and never raise the issue of rock stars, TV anchormen, or athletes, or movie stars' pay, or the leveraged buyout executives' pay, are the guys who shoot dice all day in Wall Street in the big casino in New York. But we're suddenly going to regulate a doctor's pay who didn't have to be a doctor, could have gone to Wall Street with his wonderful mind and played the money game, could have done a lot of things. It is ludicrous to single out any one profession to regulate their pay. I hope they don't consider that. I haven't heard it lately. I hope they've dropped it. Because that, if you're going to do it, we've got to be fair. We've got to create it on a social scale. Who contributes the most to the country? And, boy, that'll turn the world upside down, because we pay people the most who contribute the least. We pay most to people who will entertain us. It's a funny country, but that's the way it goes.
We're in Ross Perot's office in Dallas. We go next to Detroit.
Hello, Mr. Perot.
How are you?
Good. How are you doing today? I'm very proud to be able to speak with you. I just want to know I voted for you. Along with the health care, just kind of get something on your side there. I had a question for you about the crime. I'm from the Detroit area, and it seems like 25 minutes out of our half-hour news report is just on crime alone. Violent crimes, carjackings, gangs, murder, you name it. And I was just wondering as far as what your opinion or your thoughts would be about violent crimes. Just as far as I'm afraid even to have children to see what the world would be like, the type of violence that will seems like it's just increasing day by day as far as for my children and your grandchildren, what your thoughts are to possibly try to curb that or stop that.
All right, we got several things that are causing it. When I was a child in the Depression and people could have a rational reason for breaking in your house and stealing things because they were so poor, we left the doors unlocked. The kind of things that happen today never happened then, and times were a lot harder then. So what has changed? The family unit has broken down. Nothing will ever replace a good mother and father teaching a child the golden rule, or to treat people with care and sensitivity and not to hurt other people. Then we got a dose at home, we got a dose in school, we got a dose in scouting, you got a dose in your Sunday school or your place of worship, and society reflected that. Our children see unbelievable violence day after day after day on television, in the movies. They're exposed to it everywhere they turn. And if they just watch the news, you're right, they see it again. It becomes thinkable when you see it again and again and again. You become desensitized to it when you see it again and again and again. We have the most violent, crime-ridden society in the industrialized world. That's unacceptable. That's one of the things that motivates our organization. We're determined to make the neighborhood safe again. The saddest phenomenon in our country is that we have millions of innocent people who put themselves in jail, who've had to put bars on their windows and bars on their doors to protect themselves because society has abandoned their neighborhood and law enforcement effectively has abandoned their neighborhood. Then you've got drugs. A huge piece of the stealing is from drugs. We have got to get drugs out of our society. Now, we like to talk about it. We don't like to do it. We've got to do it. It's going to be tough to do. We can do it because we will never be a great society again until we get rid of drugs. We have got to deal with the criminal in such a way that it becomes unthinkable to do the things that are easily thinkable now. Let's assume that you were drunk and high, had a gun, and said, let's go do a drive-by shooting. But let's assume that you knew that if you ever used any weapon, a gun, a knife, you name it, to inflict violence on another human being, you would never come out of jail. I don't care how screwed up your mind was from the liquor or the drugs. You'd probably say, I don't think I'm going to do it tonight. Right now, you know you're not going to do much time. I was just hearing about a man coming in tonight that did 14 years. He was supposed to do a whole lot of time because he molested and killed a little girl. And now his problem is they let him out of jail after 14 years and none of the communities want him in their community. Well, that guy should never have come out of jail. See, if you can't do the time, don't commit the crime. That's straight off the streets of New York City. We got to get back to that now. It's got to be tough. We've had out-of-control crime in our country in the past. We had to deal with it harshly now. Sadly enough, we're far more concerned about the rights of criminals than we are the law-abiding citizen. We've got to have a balance there. And we now have a prison system where it costs as much to keep a young man in prison as it would to send him to Harvard. Something is squirrely there. This is all the court decisions and what have you, to make prison air-conditioned, have televisions and recreation rooms, and a lot of things that young people starting out, working hard, both parents working hard to make ends meet, don't have. We got to straighten all that out. Now, it's our country. We own it. We can do it.
question is, are we going to sit around here and talk about it, or are we going to do it?
Carlsbad, California, you're on with Ross Perot.
Yes, Mr. Perot, I did donate to United We Stand, although I do vote for Libertarian Party consistently. I would ask that you might do a favor for the masses out here. When the new health plan is unveiled, and as you say, I agree with you that we should take a close look at before we comment on it, would you please make it a point to ask the congressmen and the senators that they would have to live by the same health plan that they pass for the mass? As you're aware, they pass these mandates such as OSHA and EEOC, and they don't have to abide by them.
No, they have a far better health care plan than you and I have. They have a far better pension plan than you and I have. And one of the things we're pushing for as an organization, it makes no sense, since we're the only country, we're the bosses, it makes no sense for the people who work for us to have benefits we don't have. There, 93 members of Congress have individual retirement plans worth well over $1 million. You've got their health care plan is far better than that the private citizen has. It's far better than the new plan that the president will come up with. They shouldn't have better plans than you and I have. And finally, they got a cost of living adjustment on their pay every time the dollar gets weaker. They have no incentive at all to keep the dollar strong. You and I don't get that. That's all part of our government reform plan. We're working on it night and day. We'll get there. It may take a little time. It may not be pretty. We'll get there.
Jessup, Maryland, go ahead, please.
Yeah, Mr. Perot?
Yes.
Although I'm only 14 years old, I like to say I voted for you in my school election.
Thank you.
And then my dad's in the U.S. military. He's in the Navy. And what do you think about Clinton's military pay freeze, and then he's trying to raise taxes on the middle class? Because we just moved back to the States, and then my dad's barely has enough money to buy food, and he's paying for a house. What would you do in Clinton's place?
Well, I think if you saw the first part of the show, you must know how I feel about the men and women in the armed forces. Did you see the first part of the show?
I don't think he's still on.
Okay. They risk their lives for us. Your dad puts his life on the line for all of us. You can never repay people for that. Now, the history of our country is as soon as the threat of war is over, we tend to dismantle and trash the military. That's wrong. And certainly, I would want to be very careful about that. I'm sure our president wants to be very careful about that. And we really, really have to not let history repeat itself here. Because these people just didn't serve like people inside the Beltway do, go to the office, sit there all day, every day. They fought, bled, died for us, and left parts of their bodies on the battlefield. And I've got more friends than I want to think about who died on the battlefield and whose names are on the Vietnam Wall. And you can never replace a missing parent in a family. I know because I'm close to their children. And that is the ultimate sacrifice. So we must be fair and we must be square and not get into this, let's go hack it out of the military because they don't have a special interest group, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, and they don't have a lobbying team in Washington. That's why they're vulnerable. If they were like the other special interests, if they were like the Mexican government, they'd have a big lobbying team and be in good shape. As pathetic as that sounds. Nobody's asked me about the Mexican trade agreement. I hope somebody will.
Omaha, you're next.
Hello.
Hello, Omaha. You're on the air.
Thank you very much. Mr. Perot?
Yes.
I'm Betty Gersten from Omaha, Nebraska. We've been a military family for 30 years, retired from the military. My husband flew the SR-71. My son is an F-16 pilot. And my other son works on the B-2 bomber. We are behind you all the way. I'm a part of your organization and proudly pay my dues. And I want to say that you're the best thing that has ever come to this country in all my 55 years of life.
You're very kind, but I'm insignificant compared to you and your family.
No.
Because when you look at, just go through all the members of your family who put their lives on the line for this great country. Now, everybody who's listening, who doesn't put their life on the line, don't we owe people who put their lives on the line a great country in strong financial shape, a country that is a beacon to the world, a country that does have alabaster cities that gleam undimmed by human tears? We owe people like you a debt we can never repay. So, and believe me, the American people love you and respect you. Nobody is more loved and respected than the men and women in the armed forces. Now, if you look at how legislation gets, sloshed around sometime, I know you must wonder.
But out where the rubber meets the road, just go out and meet and talk to the real people. You're their heroes, and we owe you. And I think the greatest, if we could give you and your families anything you want, it would be the kind of country that you fought, bled, and died for. And that's what we're going to do.
United We Stand America, how often do you meet?
Well, our people meet locally all the time. And they're involved in school board elections, city council elections, bond elections, county elections, state elections, and then we all kind of get semi-organized and work at the national level, national elections.
Do you meet with any group on a regular basis?
Sure.
How do you find out what they think?
I get a steady flow of what they think. I am on the phone with the members all the time. For example, when we have a big campaign like the Texas Senate campaign, our role was to stage debates across Texas and give the 20-some-odd candidates a forum, which most of them wouldn't have had. Make sure everybody got heard. Then we came down to the runoff and we gave the last two candidates a forum all the way across Texas. Then after the last debate, we had a postcard in every home of the members of United We Stand, said, should we support one candidate or not? Or should we just remain neutral? 84% of them came back and said we should publicly support this candidate. We announced our support, but not until after the last debate. Take a look at the polls that were done just before we announced the support. Take a look at the election results a few days later. You'll see the difference. Arkansas, same general format on the lieutenant governor's race. So there's a pattern developing here, but probably. Now, here's the thing I love. See, we sort of have a way we do this now. But one state will pop up with a way that's 10 times better because the ideas come from them. The postcard idea came from Texas, and people said, it's a pretty good, simple idea, and we use it. But the story of my business success is listen, listen, listen to the people who do the work and listen to your customers. The people who are out there making this organization go are the local people. We are still building our communication network, but because it's a massive one, but by the end of the year, we will have terrific two-way communication that allows us to get great ideas in an instant, mass-produce them across the country in an instant, get the criticism in and get it to the top in an instant and say, why are we doing this? Why don't we do this better? So on and so forth. Any time that we are together as a large group, like I'll be in seven giant rallies this weekend in New York and Pennsylvania, I will go down the things we're working on and say, do you agree that these are our right priorities or not? And I'll get a reaction from the audience. In other words, are there other things that we should put ahead of these things? So we try to really stay focused on what the group wants us to do, and we get a great deal of constructive feedback from the group.
Los Angeles, you're next.
Hi, Ross.
Yes, sir.
Gaylord Roloff.
Right.
I'm concerned with the people that are on Social Security. I've heard a lot about this government reform within the administration, but I haven't heard anything in regards to drawing up an equity between Congress's pension and the people that are on Social Security. These are the people who built the country. I'm wondering, is anything being done? What's the status of the congressional pension plan? Can we as citizens declare the country bankrupt and just start from zero again with their pension?
Nobody wants to talk about the congressional pension plan. It's a good one in Washington. We have millions of Americans across the country who have that as a high priority. They'll have to account for that in 94. It makes no sense, as I said earlier tonight, that they would have a pension plan better than the working American because they work for us. We need to bring them down to earth. We do not need a royal congressy and an imperial presidency. We need to get rid of most of the royal trappings that are up there. Most of them were put in as an excuse during the Cold War. Maybe they were needed during the Cold War. The Cold War is over. Keep in mind, Harry Truman, as vice president, lived in a $140 a month apartment. Made $12,500 as vice president. FDR used to fly to conferences in World War II on Pan Am Clippers. All this royal stuff came up after the war, and we, the taxpayers, pay for it. And one of the evolutionary things that's popped up is the cost of living adjustments on everything and these incredible government pension plans. And the pay that Congress gives itself far exceeds the deterioration in the dollar. If you go back to 1950 and what Congress was making then, around $12,000 a year, the dollar is worth a fifth as much as it was in 1950. So it's worth about 20 cents, today's dollar. Well, multiply 12,500 times 5, and you do not get $133,600 a year. Congress has been taking good care of itself. One of our dreams is that if they want us to sacrifice, not a dream, we felt if they wanted us to sacrifice, they should take a 10% pay cut. The president should take a 10% pay cut. As a matter of principle and leadership, all sacrifice should start at the top. Nobody did that, but there's still time to get it done. They'll be very sensitive in 94. We'll have it up again. It ought to be done. It's fair.
Springfield, Virginia for Ross Perot.
Hi, Mr. Perot. The lifting of the trade embargo with Vietnam. And I want to know what you feel that we should do to encourage President Clinton to not, in fact, lift the trade embargo and to, in fact, seriously negotiate for the live POWs that are still being held in Southeast Asia. Thank you.
First off, nobody has ever seriously negotiated for them. The worst mistake we ever made. Now, everybody at the top of our government has now admitted during the Kerry committee hearings, Senate hearings on MIAs recently, that we left men behind. I've known that since the end of the war. We left over 300 men behind conservatively. They now have declassified all the documents, and it's just staggering. After the war, there's correspondence between the Secretary of Defense and one of the key State Department officials saying we may have to start bombing in Laos again to get our POWs back. We're in the middle of Watergate, and suddenly on April 13th, 1973, a man named Roger Shields was ordered to declare there are no more living Americans in Southeast Asia. And they are still sitting on who gave him that order. But that doesn't matter. We left men behind. You never leave a man behind on the battlefield. They're our sons and daughters. They're just like you and I. We sent them out to fight for us, and we don't leave them. And we sure don't leave them at the end of the war. The question now is anybody still alive? The assumption we have to make is that there is at least one alive. And there's every reason to believe, up through data as late as 1991, hard data, that people were still alive. We must resolve this problem before we normalize relations, because if we don't, the pragmatic thing for the Vietnamese to do would be to dispose of anyone still alive. Dead men tell no tales. In this environment, making money in Vietnam, doing business in Vietnam, is insignificant compared to one American life. Now, as far as I'm concerned, and I think I speak for America, if there's one left and he is dying, and the day we get him, we bring him back to the United States and he dies 1 minute after he lands, it's just as important as if there were 1,000. Never forget the old Bible verse, not even a sparrow falls to the ground without God's care. These are eagles, not sparrows. You don't leave them behind.
Lincoln, Maine. Go ahead, please.
Hello, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm a computer teacher for a vocational school in rural Maine. This is a high school. We have students numbering less than 250. We have just recently hired a firm to implement total quality, affecting students, community, parents, and co-workers. What thoughts are really rural students in our country need not to be forgotten? What thoughts would you give our school and students on total quality? And also, as you were coming down your hallway at the very beginning of the program, you mentioned something about people are going to get anything that they ask about the order. Well, I'm about to ask the order. Would you please visit our school to enhance our total quality goals, not for your political reasons, not for a media show, but just to spark interest in students who are our future.
Where are you located?
I'm located in Lincoln, Maine.
All right, do me a favor. Call my office tomorrow, and if I do, and when I do things like this, we would have had a quiet understanding that I don't want any media there. I'd be happy to do it. Look forward to it. But I want to do it for the children, and I don't want anybody else around. Fair enough?
Sounds excellent. Excellent.
Now.
Thank you. Yes.
And so give me a call tomorrow, and we'll work it out.
Caller, where is Lincoln, Maine?
Lincoln, Maine is located about 35, 40 miles north of Bangor, Maine.
Little town, right? Small community?
Very. Lincoln is about 5,000 population.
How many?
5,000.
That's per... See... The best schools left in this country are in small towns. One of my observations from being around public schools for a long time is that the quality of the public schools is in inverse proportion to the size of the city. And as an absolute correlation, the quality of the school board is an inverse relationship to the size of a city. Little towns have the best people in town on the school board. Big cities have the world's most rotten and corrupt school boards, typically. There may be a few exceptions. But I can take you to cities where janitors make more than teachers and only clean the cafeteria once a week. That's politically corrupt. That's taxpayer money for children's education. It's this kind of junk that has given us, the American people, the worst public school systems in the industrialized world. In 1960, as late as 1960, we were the envy of the industrialized world. I can't live with that. That's on our high priority list. We're going to have the finest schools in the world for our children. Now, particularly if we're going to ship all our jobs to Mexico. Nobody will bring this up tonight. I've just put out a new book on the Mexican trade agreement, and the jobs will go to Mexico, and we've gone through this 1,000-page agreement in great detail. It'll be in the bookstores on Labor Day. Every working American needs to read this book and study it and understand it. And you will not believe that people representing you made agreements this one-sided. Bluntly put, in the world our children will live in, the greatest gift we can give them are fully developed intellects. And with the worst public school system in the industrialized world, they're not in the game. And particularly as we deindustrialize our great country and ship all our factories overseas, which is what we're doing. Now, to all you folks in the armed forces who have been talking to me tonight, make it clear to everybody you meet that we can't defend this country if we don't manufacture here. It's pretty simple. You cannot go to countries around the world and beg for tanks, airplanes, and steel, and weapons. We have to make things here. We're deindustrializing our country, and it all has to do with lobbying and money and manipulation. And we're destroying the tax base that could give us the revenues to balance our budget and straighten out our country for our children. Surely we're not that dumb.
Would you mind if I see that book?
Sure.
I just want to add, on the cover here it says, with Pat Choate.
Yes, Pat Choate.
Who's written a book on...
the book, Agents of Influence, who talks in great detail in that book about the impact of foreign lobbyists.
Why did you choose him to...
Because he has spent months going through the 1,000-page volume. He's a PhD, he's an economist, he's a man that understands trade, and he was a big help in getting the book done. I wanted to make sure that it was dead accurate. That's it, and Pat played a huge role in making sure that this thing will stick.
I've got the copies of your other books here. I just wondered if you can tell us how many copies of these sold.
One was on the bestseller list, number one on the bestseller list, one of them. For 15 weeks, number one. The other one, all my pals rib me about this. We were number two on the bestseller list, I think, for 12 weeks, but we couldn't get past a book on menopause. So all my friends thought that was pretty funny. But it's over a million books. Now, this book, I'm hoping that everybody who works in this country will read this book. And then in the back of the book, I think you'll like this. Excuse me just a minute. In the back of the book, after you finish, I've got the name, address, telephone number, and fax number of every congressman and senator. So if you think we ought to pass this agreement, call them and tell them. If you think this agreement will devastate your job and your company, call them and tell them. This gets right down to facts. So right there in the back when you finish and you say, look, we should do this or we shouldn't do it, while it's still on your mind, all you have to do is flip back here. You've got the telephone number, the fax number, or the name and address. Let them know how you feel. They work for you. If you start doing that, we'll take our country back.
Deer Lodge, Montana, you're next with Ross Perot.
Thank you. It's nice talking with you, Ross.
Yes, sir.
There's been three things that's kept America free and beautiful and out of debt. One of them's been farming and agriculture. One of them's been timber and lumber industry. And one of them's been mining. Right. And right now, our government has all of them all but shut down. They're selling the logs, they're putting people out of work, they're closing down the miners, their farmers are in trouble. This is what needs to be changed.
Well, when you read those parts of the Mexican trade agreement, you're going to say, well, it's a bad situation getting stranger. But now let's go to the big picture. Only in America would we be cutting logs, putting them on ships, sending them to Japan, turning those logs into paper, having that paper sent back across the Pacific and sold in the U.S. Can we agree on that?
We do.
I mean, that is the dumbest idea I've ever heard of in my life. That's how we do things today. We've got loggers up there in the Northwest who are really being hurt. I spent some time on that. This is the problem of the owl. And I finally asked, how many owls are there? And it's a tiny number of owls. And I have a proposed suggestion, which will upset some people, but it's a practical suggestion. I suggest we send Air Force One out there, put each one of them on Air Force One, fly them to a large national park with a comfortable environment, comfortable trees, a place where they can live in comfort and luxury, where no trees will be cut, and then go back to intelligent logging. Now, mining, we've got to continue mining in this country, and just if we lose our ability to mine, to log, and now farming, while you read the Mexican trade agreement on farming, look at the levels of pesticide that they can put on fruit and vegetables shipped to our country and sell to our children. They still use DDT and things that are no longer possible in this country, but under NAFTA, they can legally ship all of that up, put it on the table, and according to our medical experts, that stuff causes cancer. But that's all right, because there's $30 million worth of lobbying behind it, so you just ram it through, and after all, these just ordinary people eating vegetables, and it probably won't give them cancer for 20 years, and who'll ever correlate the whole thing? Well, if we agree to deals like that, we deserve what happens to us. And our farmers are the backbone of this country. We were a much better country when we had a higher percentage of our people on the farms, because the farmers were self-reliant people who stood on their own feet. They reared good, strong children, sacrificed, got them through to college, and they made enormous contributions to our country because of the discipline they learned on the farms. Several years ago, someone said in my computer business, said, in all the studies you've done about people, if you could pick one category, what would it be? I said, I'd like to find Mormons who grew up on a dairy farm. Mormons because of the family values, because they had a mission and matured early as a result of going off to spend 2 years to help other people and have a strong moral ethical base. I'd like for them to grow up on a dairy farm because they learned discipline. They had to milk those cows and clean the barn twice a day. And they grew, at 21, they were 40. Now, that's something the farmer gave this country that we're losing. We're down to roughly 2% of our people farming, most productive farmers in the world. You look at parts of this Mexican trade agreement, you're going to get hurt again. You look at the wheat deal we cut so that Canada can ship wheat to Mexico, you've already gotten hurt on that. And it's for diplomatic reasons. So, after all, diplomacy is far more important than the well-being of the average American citizen in our country. So I'm sure you understand, and you'll continue to just take it on the chin. And if we're that dumb, we deserve to get it on the chin.
If you've just joined us, we're in Ross Perot's Dallas office, and we go next to Charleston, South Carolina. Go ahead, please.
Yes, good evening, Ross.
How are you?
Oh, I'm just fine, and you, sir?
Fine.
My question is concerning illegal immigration. You know, that's a big problem, especially in California, but I understand all along the border states. And how do you feel that that ties in with the NAFTA agreement and how we should handle that aspect of negotiations when it comes up?
I love that one. I've had people with PhDs say, well, this will help the immigration problem. I said, we'd be better off just to give each one of them $100,000 at the border and suggest they go home than to fix it this way, because we're taking jobs from American people. But you're a bright, talented young Mexican, and the Mexicans are good workers. They're very good workers. You're working for 58 cents an hour, or maybe a dollar an hour. If you throw all your benefits in, maybe $1.60. And you know that you can come across the border where the minimum wage is $4.25. You can get on welfare. You can get free health care, so on and so forth. You're still coming in big numbers, because living in a one-room shack with a dirt floor in Mexico is not as good as the life you could have here in the United States. Now, speaking of that, you're not going to, as we used to say in Texas, you ain't going to believe this story. Mexican companies can put together teams of Mexican workers, bid on projects in the United States, pay them Mexican wages. You can't compete with that in the United States. And they can also bid on government projects, believe it or not, ship those workers into the United States, take American jobs, and leave them indefinitely. Now, only in America and only in Washington and only because of foreign lobbyists could you make a deal that stupid. Now, this is what's happening to our great country. So this immigration thing will be stimulated, not slowed down, by this agreement.
We have got to turn immigration back into a rational process. Remember when they used to come wait in line, come through Ellis Island? We got to go back to that. We cannot just be a dumping ground in this country when our people are out of work and we're $4 trillion in debt. We got to get our house back in order. Once we're rich again, we can do more for people who are poor. The finest person you ever knew in your life who gave most of what he or she had when they were wealthy and suddenly was broke, they have the same impulse, but they can't do it. That's where we are now. We're broke. We got to fix that.
In your new book, Save Your Job, Save Our Country, Why NAFTA Must Be Stopped Now, which is due out when? Labor Day?
It'll be out on Labor Day, and that's no coincidence because it's for every working American. Then we'll be having rallies across the country. We have a big one in September in Detroit. I hope everybody that works in Michigan will be there. And we will be letting Congress know how the people who work feel about having their jobs stolen and taken overseas. Go to Hong Kong, drive the first 40 miles into China. It's nonstop construction on both sides of the road. Nothing like it in this country. Those are the jobs that used to be here.
In the back under Appendix A, you list the people who have been working, former officials of the U.S. government, who are now working for NAFTA's passage, and you list Tony Anaya, who used to be the governor of New Mexico. You list William Brock, who used to be the Secretary
of
Labor.
He's the quarterback. Oh, wait, whoa. He was also the chief trade negotiator for the United States of America.
He is
considered the principal architect of NAFTA. Now,
let me list just a couple more here. You also list William Hildenbrand, who was the Secretary of the Senate. You list Martin Gold, who was legal counsel for Senator Howard Baker. You list Howard Liebengood, who was a sergeant at arms. You list Phil Potter, who's with Walker & Associates, and Charlie Walker, who's with Charlie Walker. And you list Jim Smith with Charlie Walker. Charlie Walker was a deputy secretary of the Treasury. Why'd you do this?
Because everybody wants to know who are all these foreign lobbyists. Those are the principal players on NAFTA.
Do you know how much money they are paid?
Yes, I think that's in various places in the book. We talk about the fees that they're paid, and they're substantial. Very substantial. These are guys, just hired guns.
Let's go back to the phones. Walnut Ridge, Arkansas. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Ross, this is very fine to be able to talk to you.
Thank you.
I am a veteran first, World War II, and I happened to meet you once in the Excelsior Hotel in Little Rock, Arkansas, when you was running for president.
Right.
The question I have with you is, I worked very diligently with the MIAs and POWs, but you brought out one point that you say that you listen to somebody that gives you a thought of what family life is like. And one of my thoughts is, and it certainly is appropriate for you, that is the fingers of thought always caressing and molding your face. And our deeds determine us as we determine our deeds. And you certainly fit that picture.
Well, you're very kind. Now, back to MIAs. There is a clear record that our fighting men from Korea and from Vietnam were taken to Russia. We want those men back, or we want their remains back. We have testimony of things and medical experiments that were done to those men that are just atrocious. I don't care how damaged a person may be as a result of radiation exposure or chemical warfare exposure, believe it or not, or mind-altering drugs exposure. If he or she is still alive, every American wants that person back in this country. We will take care of them and treat them as heroes for the rest of their lives. If they're dead, we want their remains. We are absolutely unwilling to leave one behind. And that takes me back to Vietnam. It's a principle here. Our organization has formally agreed to use all of the members and the resources at our disposal to help this tiny number of families of MIAs who don't have a voice to have an effective voice because of this principle. You'll say, well, Ross, in the country's priorities, this is not like paying the bills. This is not like campaign reform. No. But there's a principle here. What kind of people are we?
Are we what we say we are? Or are we just write these people off as casualties of war and say, well, you know, what difference does it make? It's not, you know, they're not that many voters here in this group. And we got all these folks here who want to go in and try to make money. And they're pushing hard. And if we don't get in there, maybe the Japanese or others will get in ahead of us. My goodness, surely we care about these men more than that. We cannot leave them behind. Let's get them out.
San Jose, California, you're next.
Yes, Mr. Perot, my name is Ken. I'd like to know how you feel about the Grace Commission and also about abolishing the personal income taxes and putting in a national sales tax.
Let me add to that the reinventing government program that Vice President Gore's been heading up is expected to make their ideas known after Labor Day. From what you've been hearing about that program, what do you think of it?
Well, I haven't heard enough to have an opinion. So I'm looking forward to hearing all about it. I hope it's a great program. I think it's a great idea. Let's wait and see, and let's hope they come up with some really good stuff, because there's a lot of really good. Mr. Grace, the Peter Grace Commission, did a brilliant job. The government wouldn't follow through. He made an incredible contribution to this country with his plans, but then it's not politically popular to have any discipline around spending, as you know, because Congress assumes that money falls out of the sky. Money comes off the sweat of the brow of millions of hardworking Americans in Washington. It should be spent like you use water in the desert. And I don't have to tell you all, it's not. It's just thrown around and wasted. If you look at this year's pork, it'll make you sick. You got to have a line item veto and give the president the chance to cut it out. Let me make one thing very clear on the MIAs. I think if President Clinton, who is a caring person, ever really understands this issue and ever understands and knows and looks at the documents that are available and declassified now, as bright as he is, he will be stunned that we left them behind. He will move heaven and earth to get them back. And he is in a unique position to get it done as our commander-in-chief. So I hope he'll have the opportunity to really get a full briefing. The families want to give him a briefing. The families are worried that they won't be able to give him a briefing. I have said, there's no question in my mind that he will see you. Your challenge is to really be organized and make sure you have all your documents straight and make it a productive briefing. That could change that whole event.
When was the last time you talked to the president?
Never say who I talked to. If they want to say it, they can.
How about Bob Dole?
I don't ever discuss that. It's their prerogative. When they call me or I call them, it's always with the understanding I don't discuss it.
What's your reaction to all this copy about possibly running as a Republican in 96?
That's just Washington. Never been a word of discussion about it, never been a minute of thought about it.
What was your reaction to Vincent Foster's suicide?
Broke my heart.
What about all the...
But let's stay there.
All right, I wanted to ask you about all the comment made about Washington.
When I saw his family's pictures, I saw his wife, I saw his children. Here is a nice, good, decent man with a really nice, wonderful family that was so battered by the Washington environment that he took his life. And I am really saddened that inside the Beltway people don't back off and say, why do we want to destroy people? But now they're saying it had to be genetic, he had to have... You see, it's all these things. To the best of my knowledge from reading what I can about him, there's no medical evidence that he had a history of depression. Here is a man that was an outstanding student, an outstanding athlete. Everything about him would lead to great self-confidence. You look at his family, he had a wonderful family, and now he is gone because probably he was so hurt by what was happening to him there. Now, that guarantees that the best people in our country will not go to Washington, have themselves trashed, and have their families trashed. That's sad. So who goes? People whose drive for power and ego drive is so great that they will endure all that trash just to have their hand on the throttle. Those are not the people we want there. No. Vince Foster, my heart broke. And it's any time it comes up, I just think, God bless him. So sad. He had a wonderful life, a wonderful professional position in Arkansas. He left all that to work for a fraction of what he was making to serve his country and just got his head torn off. And I think it broke his heart.
Cleveland, Ohio, you're next.
Hi, Mr. Perot. Nice to have the opportunity to ask a question. I'd like to say that I voted for you, and I think you make a lot of sense, certainly compared to the competition. But a lot of people were disappointed when you left the race last year, and they don't quite appreciate your explanation for why you did that, and as a result, I don't think take you very seriously anymore. How do you feel about that in retrospect?
That's fine. Let them feel any way they want to. I have to do what I have to do.
Well, what do you have to say about why you left the race? And I mean,
no
why
more
could,
than why I've could, covered all. I've covered all that. I've said it, and I don't. Anybody that's upset about it, just probably not interested in what I have to say. But I have my priorities in life, and I am not going to let anybody damage my children.
Final comment, Cleveland?
Could have stood in there and taken the heat.
If it was aimed at me, there's no problem. You follow me?
Yes, no, I do.
Do you have children? Do you have children?
No, I don't.
Okay, then there's something, see, no, me take the heat, fine. I take the heat, no sweat. But what was going on was just so sick and so rotten that I had to protect my children from that. And then after that event passed, climbed back in the ring, we went forward. Now, that's just me, and I'm not going to change. So if you don't like that, if you don't want a guy that cares that much about his family, fine. But what you see is what you get.
The Wall Street Journal this morning has an editorial that says, you're going to talk on this program about discharge petitions,
yes.
and we haven't talked about
no,
it.
No, we've got to. Now, there is a great editorial here. We've got, see, one man with courage is all it takes. There's this congressman from Oklahoma, Inhofe, who basically has said there's a gag rule, and this keeps good legislation like term limits, which we want. See, we've asked for we've said, come up with your overall plan to balance a budget. Then have a term limits law that kicks in if you don't stay on schedule. That's discipline on spending. Okay, term limits, balanced budget amendment, line item veto, all these things get locked up, and there's this little rules committee, and there's the gag rule. We want to get rid of the gag rule. We want to get this legislation moving. We've got a chance to do it on September the 8th. They're just a few votes shy. Now, everybody who has not signed on to it is in this editorial. This editorial appeared earlier this week in the Wall Street Journal. If you can't figure out, whether your congressman's on or off, get busy and find out, and I'm sure continue to read the Wall Street Journal and other publications. They'll tell you who's on and who's off. Make sure your congressman understands that you want the legislation to move. You don't like all of these dumb rules they have. You don't like this secret game they play with your money. And you'll get this. You know why you'll get it? All of these boys are running in 94, and they're not kamikazes. Now, you've got almost as many as you need right here doing the right thing. You need a few more votes. Let's get it. Now, we can't waste time here. I know you're getting ready for Labor Day. September the 8th, they're going to vote on this. Before September the 8th, you've got to make sure your congressman understands in living color that you're tired of the Washington game, that you want out in the open legislation. And you want these bills to move and not have a few powerful people be able to bottle them up, even though most of the Congress wants them to go.
Do you have any idea how the Wall Street Journal knew you were going to talk about this tonight?
No.
It's on one of the editorials today.
Let me try to piece it together. I was talking to Congressman Inhofe. I told him I was going to be talking with you and that I wanted to bring it up tonight. And I'm delighted I got the chance to. So they are obviously talking to him. He probably told them. That must be it.
We understand you'll agree to stay another half hour.
If I haven't worn everybody out.
We brought 8 people down here, a long trip from the governor's conference. So if you're game, we're game for another half hour.
No, nothing is more fun than visiting with the American people. This is as good as having time inside the Beltway is bad. So, I mean, for every day in the Beltway, you need to have an offsetting day like this.
Panama City, Florida. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, thanks for taking my call, Ross. I'm a 12-year United States Marine and a member of United We Stand, and I really appreciate what you're doing and the dedication to destroying the NAFTA. I took part and did my thing to send off everything to my representatives that you asked for us, And I've also looked towards the future in aviation technology, studying in my off-duty time to arrange so that I have a future in something when I retire out of the military. But my point is, we have an armed forces of troops dedicated to solving the drug war problem, engineers ready to do the infrastructure, and we have all the leaders and all the teachers we need for building, rebuilding values. But what we lack is leadership at the top, and I sure look forward to having you someday as our commander-in-chief.
Well, you're very kind, and in Florida, keep in mind, the citrus industry is about to be nuked by the NAFTA trade agreement. You want to know the details? It's in the book. Now, think, can you imagine anybody damaging the citrus industry of Florida that's interested in politics? Let's assume they're not interested in the country. Florida has a lot of votes, right? It's a big electoral state. I'm just trying to go past the ethical part, which is don't hurt our country, and saying, even if you're just in crass politics, you don't want to do NAFTA because it damages Michigan, it damages Florida, it damages the Northeast. Only in America would you be considering passing the Mexican trade agreement and at the same time putting family leave bills in, putting the strike breaker in, putting all sorts of additional mandates on business, and all you have to do is go south of the border and escape it all, right? Make things at a fraction of what they cost up here, ship them across the border, having 18-year-old Mexican truck drivers with trucks that don't meet minimum U.S. standards with no front wheel brakes that exceed the load limits, delivering the goods. Only in America would you not allow, since 90% comes in trucks, the Mexican trucking companies have a huge advantage over the U.S. companies. And it just goes on. The shipping companies have a huge advantage over U.S. companies. Who is looking out for us? That's my question.
Three quick things. The Dallas Morning News this morning says that the NAFTA vote is up in the air. Do you have any insider feeling as to what the vote count would be now?
Well, the good news is the House is running in 94. I think I talked to you earlier about this new song that's out. It's an average citizen that's singing a song.
Your new theme song?
The possible theme song that says, I'll remember you in 94.
Remember me, you're taking all my money. Remember me, you gave my job away. Remember me, or I am just a number who wants to work and doesn't qualify for foreign aid. It goes on and on by Steve Voss. When's this coming out?
Well, pretty soon. And we'll be using it this weekend in our rallies in all the states.
Is there a tune? I mean, is there
Yes. No, it's on disc. It's on compact disc. And we're getting covered up by radio stations that are interested. I'll remember in November, as I step into the little booth, I'll remember in November to vote for anyone but you. That's the person who is not being sensitive to what the citizens want. Now, a third of the Senate's running. You passed this law that destroys the American job base, that damages the American tax base, that dramatically reduces our ability to defend our country because we can't manufacture. And the American people will be up in arms in 94 because they will understand it. And we're going to make sure they understand it. Now, this will produce a raging debate. All the other side will come out and say, no, Perot's all wrong, right? This is really good for America. And they will say brilliant things like, this creates jobs. And then you'll say, how? And they say, this has nothing to do with cheap labor. Then I say, fine, let one state be a pilot state in the United States. Let's do a one-state model for 5 years. And they say, that's the dumbest idea in the world, Ross. Every factory in the United States would go to that state. Say, I rest my case. So then they just, you march through here, it'll help immigration problem. No, it'll make it worse. Because not only will you still have people flowing across the border for decent paying jobs, you'll have all these Mexican companies shipping workers north, which they can do under NAFTA, to live here indefinitely to do work in this country at Mexican pay. Now, this is kind of like, you know, wandering around at night without your flashlight or something, I think. I welcome the debate.
We'll come back to some more questions, but we have a caller standing by in La Quinta, California.
Hi, Ross Perot. This is Dorothy Gray Johnson.
How are you?
I think everybody is kind of innocent about NAFTA. I think it's a much more evil treaty than people know. I think it goes much further than just a treaty and trading with Mexico. I think it's the beginning of America being destroyed, and this way, with the destruction of America, they can begin building for a one-world government. And it scares me to death, and what do you think of that?
Well, Well, the global economy is the underpinning for this that concept, but let's just get it back to a single issue. Do we want our country to maintain its unique sovereign position in the world? I think the overwhelming reaction of the American people is yes. Then let's not slide off the edge of the cliff. This one world stuff, we can't even get a united Europe. Now, having a good trade agreement with Mexico, fine. Having a fair trade agreement with Mexico, fine. Don't be upset at Mexico. They're good negotiators. Be upset with us. We gave away the store. I mean, we give them the watch, the ring, everything in a negotiation. They always do that. There's nothing new here. You look at our past trade negotiations, you wouldn't believe them. That's the reason we've deindustrialized our country. That's the reason 4 out of 5 Americans' standard of living was reduced in the 1980s. Now, we've got to turn that around. We can do it. We can't do it just sitting around whining. We've got to get active.
What is your reaction when you hear either the president's people, or any of the members of Congress say, Ross Perot sits away out there and pecks away at us. He's not in here making these compromises and decisions. He's got the best of all worlds. He doesn't have to come here and do the job.
That's just Washington malarkey. You know, they were elected to do the job. Once they were elected, they worked for us. I am one of 200 and some odd million people in this country. I am a proud part owner. We all have the same number of shares, one vote. I think it is very, very improper of them to criticize any citizen for speaking out. Now, I understand in their world, the only people who are supposed to have a voice are the people who gave them campaign money. And ordinary citizens are supposed to shut up and be like choir boys and send money. We're past that. Now, they've got to say something. They can't defend their position. So they throw what I call gorilla dust in the air. That's gorilla dust. That example you just gave me, when gorillas fight, they throw dust in the air to distract one another. Let's stick to the real issues. The real issue, is this a good idea or not? See, to say that I shouldn't have a voice as a citizen is to violate the Constitution. I do have a voice.
Miami, Florida, go ahead, please.
Hello, Lieutenant.
How are you?
Fine, sir, fine. You know,
who's this? Chief Chambers, right?
Yes, sir.
I'll never forget that
memory,
voice.
Sir.
You staying out of trouble?
Yeah, I'm trying to, sir. Yes, sir.
Now, wait a minute. Hold on. Where is Chief Chambers?
Chief Chambers was on the USS Sigourney with me. We went around the world together when I was an ensign.
How do you, when was the last time you talked to him?
A year ago, Chief?
When he was here in Miami, it's been about 6 months ago, something like that.
6 months ago, right. But I recognize that voice.
Go ahead, Chief, you're on.
Yeah,
ensigns don't forget chiefs.
Yes, sir. The other day I was watching on TV the governor's conference, and it seemed like the only governors he had on there was the one speaking for the trade treaty.
Right.
And I don't see how they get on there and speak up for the treaty as much as they did. And I think they need to take advice that the Hussongas had dropped out of the race, gave Governor Clinton. He was interviewed on TV, and he said, what was the best advice you can give Governor Clinton? And quote, he said, the best advice I can give Governor Clinton is tell him to listen to Ross Perot, and everything Ross Perot says, you say the same thing. The following Monday on the day show, there he was. Now, I think okay. That's what these congressmen need to do today.
Now, I think most of the governors have not read the details. See, the document is so thick. And this little book we're coming out with is a good synopsis. When they read that book, I think they'll be stunned. Then it's footnoted so they can go over to the big treaty if they want to check to see if it's accurate. I think you'll see a lot of governors change their position once they understand it. You would be stunned to realize how few members of Congress ever read the budget they passed. It's big, it's complicated. I'm sure very few people read it. Staff guys looked at it, maybe. But the typical congressman or senator never got through it. We're trying to give them something simple to look at here to shock them. I think you'll see a lot of them change their position.
Back a little bit more to the NAFTA stuff quickly. People say you've got it both ways, that your son Ross on the Alliance Project in Fort Worth is for NAFTA, you're against it. What do you say
what
to that?
What does that have to do with anything?
Well, it comes up all the time. I'm just
know,
asking you what they...
I know, but that's gorilla dust.
Why?
And 4 or 5 years ago, in a document... And see, the Alliance Airport is owned by the city of Fort Worth. It's not my son, Ross. But in a document making application for this industrial airport, one of the things was that it would be effective use if under NAFTA. Now, take me back 4 or 5 years ago. Go back and look at my old speeches. Philosophically, I am for a trade agreement with Mexico. But I am for a fair trade agreement. I've said publicly, I think at the press club, that if we're determined to send jobs out of this country, it's a whole lot smarter to send them to Mexico than it is to China. Now, just when you think that we sent jobs to China and they use prison labor and children and make gear and send it here, it's bizarre. Now, that's one of our old trade agreements. But that's China, you know, that's a special situation. Okay, then we got Guatemala. That's 25-cent labor. That's a special situation. Then we got Turkey, and to get them to come into the war, big deal, come into the war, Desert Storm. We made a big textile deal with them that really hurt us in this country. They tried to get the same deal from Europe, and Europe just laughed at them. It's in the book. This is the kind of junky stuff that goes on. Now, I don't want it both ways. Let me tell you how I could have it. I could sit in my office, keep my mouth shut, use my financial resources, and quadruple my net worth in a few years if NAFTA went through. You know why I won't do that? Because it's wrong. You know why it's wrong? It puts ordinary, decent people like my parents. See, there are few people in this country that can create jobs. There are millions of people who will work their hearts out if they have a job, but are straws in the wind in this big money game that's played. I would never be a part of buying factories, companies, moving their factories to Mexico, buy the stock, because it's a good company, good product, labor intensive in manufacturing, and has marginal profits, so I buy the stock cheap. I move the factories to Mexico. I wipe out whole towns in the United States. I dramatically reduce the cost of making the product. They never reduce the cost, the selling price of the product, so the Americans pays the same amount. The profits go through the roof. I sell the stock and go get another round of companies. Now, that's what I could do. I will not do that because it's wrong. I would like to see a good trade agreement with Mexico. I admire Mexico. I admire President Salinas. I admire his cabinet. He has got a very bright, talented group down there. And I respect the fact that they just out-traded us to a fault. I am not happy about the way money drove the deal. But they did out-trade us. Now, we cannot destroy our country and our tax base and our economic base. Everybody says, well, oh, it'll be just a small number of jobs. We have 17 million manufacturing jobs left in this country. They have 1,000,000 18-year-olds coming into the workforce each year. If they hired nobody but 18-year-olds, they could take over all the manufacturing in this country in the next 18 years. If they do a cross-section of Mexico hiring, and the Mexican worker is a great worker, we will be a third-world country. You know what our principal exports to Japan are now, don't you? It's raw materials. Coal, timber, scrap iron, it's scrap paper. I mean, it's just bizarre that our great country is becoming a third world supplier.
Rancho Cordova, California, you're next.
Hello, Brian. Hello, Ross. It's my pleasure to talk to both of you. We do want details, Brian, but what we want details on, which we didn't get, were details on the SNL debacle. We were looking to get details on BCCI. It doesn't look like that's going to happen. There's a media blackout in Mexico or on Mexico right now. We see Bosnia, but we don't see Mexico. And the Mexican people admire Ross because he is trying to do for the Americans, bring democracy to the American people, just like they want democracy down in Mexico. With the media blackout, we don't see American corporations and what they're doing in Mexico. We don't see who they're hiring or how much they're paying. And my question to Ross is, Ross, would you go down to Mexico and show the American people firsthand what's going on down there, and maybe the media will follow you? And Ross, if they pass NAFTA, the American people will stand beside you in Washington.
Well, our challenge is to make sure. Now, here's the interesting thing. In other words, if you can make a deal with Canada because their wages and benefits are comparable to ours. I've said again and again, just raise the standard of living of the American worker, make it comparable to that of the U.S. worker, then we'll go head-to-head in brains and wits competition. We will have revolution. Since all these theorists that come see me representing a who's who of American business. Now, only in America would the guy who runs the big corporation organization called USA NAFTA, guess who the president is? The recently fired chairman of Kodak, who's laying off 10,000 people. Give me a break. You follow me? Kodak? For God's sakes. Okay. Now, this game cannot be played at the expense of the American worker. We will devastate. Look, the worst thing you do to a person when you put them out of work is destroy their self-esteem. How'd you like to go home tonight and look at your wife and kids and say, I lost my job, they're moving the factory to Mexico. Son, you can't go to college next year. Whole family, we're going to have to sell the house because I can't make the mortgage payment. I'll be very lucky to make half what I used to make. I don't have a college education. I'm 55 years old. I've been making cars all my life. I did a really good job. I was a straw in the wind. Now I'm going to go out and try to get a job in a fast food restaurant or somewhere. I will cut lawns. I will haul trash. I will do anything to try to support you. But we're going to just have to sell off most of what we had as middle class Americans. And the sad thing for my country is, if that happens to me, I'm no longer a big taxpayer. I'm no longer a Social Security payer. I may be a welfare recipient. It is a triple hit to everybody else who still has a job.
Reaction to William Daley, Bill Daley being the NAFTA czar for the administration, brother of the mayor of Chicago.
I don't know him. I'm sure that he will do a good job. But I'll say this. God bless him. His job, if I understand the mission through the news, and that's all I know, is to convince American labor that this is a good thing for them. If he can do that, I'd like to hire him.
Oklahoma City, you're next.
Because we'll sell stuff all over the world. That guy, if he can make that sale, he's a good one.
Oklahoma City, go ahead, please.
Hello, Ross.
How are you?
I watch a lot of news magazine shows in the evenings and stuff like that, and they show how all your congressmen and everything like that, they subsidize the money to have extravagant lifestyles and use tax money, stuff like that. Why do we put up with it? Why do we take it? Is there anything we can do about it?
Yes, we put up with it because we're not organized. That's the reason. You're back to why we have a United We Stand America. Millions of us come together, we have a voice. We will be the largest special interest group this country's ever seen when we finish. And then we have an enormous responsibility not to become arrogant and to be very, very careful that we never do anything that's not good for our country. But we have, the ordinary citizen has the most powerful thing in this country, the vote. If that ordinary citizen is not organized to have his and her voices heard, then we get manipulated like unprogrammed little robots with these ads and all this funny stuff they think they can get away with on campaigns. All of this posturing in campaigns that has worked in the past, if we do a good job, will not work in 94. We'll have no chance of working in 96. We will be a stand-and-deliver country. And Lequalinza's words will be carved across the foreheads of everybody in public office. He told our Congress, words are plentiful, but deeds are precious. Guys, let's clean it up. Let's get it right. That's what the people want.
If you've just joined us, we're in our last half hour. What will be a 2.5-hour visit with Ross Perot here in Dallas in his office. We're on the 17th floor of his office building, and we're going to take calls until the bottom of the hour. Next call, I believe, Gerard, Pennsylvania. Go ahead, please.
Yes. I have a question for Ross out there. Please let me turn down the TV here for a second. I was wondering, first of all, my name's William Schubert. I'm 34 years old, unemployed. I have a bachelor's degree in mathematics and about 20 years worth of computer experience. My question has to do with with Ross's economic program. I'm a little nervous here, obviously. What I had an idea for was, I don't know if Ross has ever heard of a program called SimCity. It's a computer simulation of how to build a city. I was wondering if Ross had ever thought about doing that for his economic program, creating something to that effect.
Well, I have not. It's in terms of creating simulations for various economic strategies and theories and new tax plans and things like that. I trust they have things like that in Washington. I'm not sure if they do. They certainly should have them. And they certainly need them. In all candor, I've never heard of one. I hope they have it up there at OMB.
Earlier in the program, you showed some specifics. Can you get that chart out again? So if the audience joined us late, and I want to ask you about the whole idea of specifics again. Do you think the media asks you for more specifics than they do others?
I don't think so. I know so. I play a game of gotcha, but that's all right. Keep in mind, on the specific program you're talking about, the only reason I went on that program was to raise money for flood relief for people on the Mississippi River.
Was that your understanding when you...
No. I understood I had to go through the usual grilling, but I was happy to do that.
Will you do it again, that program, Meet the Press?
Well, I don't ever look back. I mean, if the interesting thing, when that was over, I left immediately after the program and flew to Branson, Missouri, and Bob Hope, God bless him, who's 90 years old, and I had a four-hour telethon to raise money for flood relief with the Country and Western Stars in Branson, Missouri. So, I mean, I had to flush it out of my mind and go do it. But the next day, the program and participants on the program called and said they had had an unbelievable angry reaction to the way that I was treated. So my theory is it didn't cost me anything, right? Television time cost me $500,000 for a half hour in some cases. So I just kind of grin and say, well, it was free. I have every confidence that the American people are smart enough to see through what's going on. Now, here is the good news. Anytime I am treated with that level of rudeness, really serious level of rudeness, our membership spikes for the next week. We get an incredible... So I sort of get up every day and say, hit me. So because it causes so many ordinary Americans who are angry to join. Now, while we're on flood relief, I can't resist. Say, the folks on the Mississippi are still hurting. The river is going down. They got to clean up their homes. They got to clean up their farms. Remember the old song, nobody does it better? Nobody does it better than the Salvation Army. Post Office Box 5, just remember the number of fingers on your hand. St. Louis, Missouri, Salvation Army. Send them whatever you can. Send cash. Got plenty of food, plenty of other stuff. We need cash now. We got to rebuild. And this is America at its best, helping other people. Don't worry for Washington to send money and waste it. Let's get into a people-to-people program and get down there where the rubber meets the road and help these folks rebuild their lives. And when you think about them, just remember the old saying, there but by the grace of God go I. Because you and I could have had a catastrophe and we'd be counting on people to help us. So let's help them.
Let me just take a minute, go back to the specifics thing. You said that you were treated rudely on Meet the Press.
Oh, but that's fine. It was free. This is what I call the pillow fight game in Washington.
But what is wrong with
don't
the reporter?
Don't you understand? Well, look, the American people understand. The way you get your raises, the way you get your bonuses, the way you get to be a big name is to do this kind of gotcha stuff. I understand that. I understand the silly game that's played. I get 30 minutes for nothing. I put up with it to talk to the American people. Big deal.
But should journalists ask for specifics of all candidates, all people in the political game?
Well, if anything they want. But, for example, if you want me to recite Webster's Dictionary, word by word on your show, and particularly if I call and say, is there something you'd like for me to bring so that I can get the level of detail you want, because this had occurred before on that particular show, and they say, no, we're just going to talk this, this, and this, and this. So I'm totally focused on flood relief. I show up figuring we're going to talk about whatever they want to talk about. And suddenly they're into minutia at a level that our government, with its whole OMB and CBO and what have you, couldn't produce on most of their stuff. But I have to. No problem. What are they trying to do? They're trying, one, discredit me, two, redefine who I am. You don't understand the game. That's the game that's played in Washington.
Why do they want to discredit you?
The funny thing now is these perspiring or aspiring presidential candidates in the Republican Party who spend all of their time making huge negative statements about me. I just sit here and laugh about it now because, see, that's their silly game. That game doesn't work anymore. I've tried, I'm saying again publicly, that won't work anymore, fellas. You got to get down to the issues that concern the people. These are subsets of the little game. Now, there are guys in Washington who make a living doing this for the political parties. The White House has a war room. They announced that they were going to take me out, and do you know what their first statement was? These are grown men in the White House at taxpayer expense saying, this is last spring, early summer, saying, and this was their opening strategy. If there were a funeral, Perot would want to be at the corpse. And if they were a wedding, he would want to be the bride. And I just laughed. I said, you don't understand me, guys. If there's a funeral, I'd want to be the undertaker or the florist. If there's a wedding, I want to sell the bride the dress or be the caterer. And worst case, I want to be father of the groom because he doesn't have to do anything. So, but don't you find it interesting that in the office of the President of the United States, you've got a room, or how do we take these people out? Why don't we take that same talent and try to create good legislation for the people? Why don't we try to do a good job for the hardworking people in this country and rebuild our country? Why are we playing this silly, childish game?
Twin Falls, Idaho, you're next.
Yes, Mr. Perot?
Yes.
Yes, you have spoken about many, many issues. If you had one special thing to tell the youth of America today, what would you tell them to help them?
What did you say, ma'am?
She had one special message for the youth of America?
Yes.
Was that it?
What would you tell them to help?
For the youth of America, I say this. The millions of people in United We Stand America have come together primarily for you. We want you to have the same opportunities we've had. We're going to see that you get them. We are not going to continue to squander your future by spending trillions of dollars that you will have to pay back. We are not going to leave huge unfunded entitlement programs that will take virtually all of your paycheck. All of these things that we are doing are the reverse of what prior generations did. Prior generations worked, sacrificed, gave the next generation a better life. The young people in this country coming out of college this year with PhD degrees in math, science, and chemistry are having trouble getting jobs. We have the largest number of young people coming out of college this year with bachelor's degrees since the end of World War II that can't get jobs. This is a big red flare in terms of the direction our country's going in. We're going to change it for you. Now, young people, we're building chapters on every college campus. You will be the Tigers on our team. And if you want to see an absolute meltdown with some of the older people in this country like myself who are getting all these benefits and so on and so forth, when the children and grandchildren sit down and talk to them, it's not even fair. They'll do anything for you. I can tell you, I have a disproportionate number of older people who come to our rallies. They will do anything for you. They want this country fixed. We don't want to turn out the lights and leave you a mess. So team up with us. We'll get it done. But it's not simple, and you won't get it done by whining, sucking your thumb, and saying, what are you going to give me, U.S. government? John Kennedy said it beautifully. Don't ask what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country. But we got to practice it. Saying it's easy, we got to live it.
Last call for our guest here in Dallas. We go to Pensacola, Florida.
Yes, sir, Mr. Perot.
How are you?
Good. I was wondering, why don't we do something simple, like just cap overall federal spending in real terms and only allow for increases in inflation? I mean, that's something the American people can understand. And it's
no,
simple.
No, absolutely. But the reason we don't do it is because everybody's got his finger in the pie. Everybody's got his hand in the trough. Everybody's got his special deal. And nobody is looking after the taxpayers' money. If you, for example, we've just told the American people from Washington that we're going to cut spending, so on and so on. The facts are we spent $1.2 trillion in 1992. We're spending about $1.4 trillion this year. Now then, with the new big exotic plan in place, in 1996, we will have gone from $1.2 trillion in 1992 to $1.7 trillion in 1996. Now that's the forecast. It'll probably be more than that. That is not cutting spending. If you and I are in our lives, we're spending more than we can afford. Let's assume we had $1,000 to spend. We're spending $1,500. We'd have to cut back to $1,000. That's what you're saying. That's common sense. That's plain talk. That is the kind of thinking that we'll get if we ever get a balanced budget amendment, unless they slip in a little loophole. So you got to be very, very observant as these things happen. We want a real balanced budget amendment that forces financial discipline on our country.
Think you'll ever get tired of this?
That's not the issue. Just total candor, the American people know this. I don't like to do this.
You don't like any of it?
No.
You don't enjoy sitting here for 2.5 hours?
No. I love the American people. That's why I'm doing it. But it is not anything that any rational person, I think, would say they enjoy. The other side of it, just all of the silly games that are played in Washington, you put up with that, see. And when you think of poor Vince Foster, he couldn't put up with it. He's a good man, good family, And they just, no, that's, I'm insensitive to all that. But in terms, I am going to do it because I ought to do it. As long as the American people want me to do it, I'll be there. Now, so that, just put that away. That I, but in terms, do I get a rush of power from this? No, I am not power hungry, never have been. All of that stuff is sick in my mind.
All right, hypothetical. I know you don't like them, yeah, but still. What if the volunteers got you into another presidential race and you won and you found yourself in Washington, D.C. and you had to deal with it on site? What would you do to protect yourself from getting involved like you say everybody else does it goes there?
Well, first off,
go there.
If I am ever there, it will be to fix the problem. I made it very clear during the campaign that I would take no compensation if I were ever elected. I made it very clear that I would serve one term so that I didn't have to start thinking about re-election the second day in office. And I made it very clear that I would bring in the finest people from both parties and we would build a coalition government and that we would stop being Democrats, stop being Republicans, stop being independents, and we would all be Americans for 4 years. And if I couldn't get it done in Washington because I got there because of the will of the American people in a totally unorthodox way, I would keep going back to the American people to shape up the guys in Washington, and we would get it done because they own the country. Be kind of like making sausage. Wouldn't be pretty to watch it, but when we got through it, it tastes good.
We better quit.
Great to be with you, Brian.
Thank you, Ross Perot, and I want to thank Steve Scully, who's our producer here. We even have the Vice President of Programming with us, Terry Murphy, who came from the convention over in Tulsa with the governors, and Eric Hansen, our director for this end of things, and in Washington, Mike McNamara and Kevin Washburn, and a team of tens.
Right.
Thank you very much for joining us. Thanks to the audience for your calls. Have a good day.
C-SPAN is making both videotapes and printed transcripts of this conversation with Ross Perot available to viewers. For a VHS copy, send a check or money order for $39.95 to C-SPAN Viewer Services, 400 North Capitol Street, Washington, D.C. The zip code is 20001. And for a printed transcript, send a check or money order for $10 to C-SPAN Transcripts, care of Tapewriter Incorporated. Post Office Box 885, Lincolnshire, Illinois, 60069. C-SPAN 2, like its companion network C-SPAN, is funded entirely by America's cable television companies as a public service.
Now here is a look at what's ahead on the C-SPAN 2 schedule tonight. Please remember that all times mentioned here are Eastern times only. Coming next on C-SPAN 2, some of this week's summer meeting of the National Governors Association, which took place this year in Tulsa, Oklahoma. We begin with the opening session of the conference from last weekend. Then, at 9 o'clock, it's President Clinton's speech to the governors. The president appeared before the governors on Monday, and he discussed health care reform. Then at 9:50 p.m., we'll bring you some reaction to the president's speech from two Republican governors, Pete Wilson of California and Carol Campbell of South Carolina. And then at 10 o'clock tonight, it's the governor's working session on the North American Free Trade Agreement and other economic issues. And that's what's ahead in the next few hours tonight on C-SPAN 2.
C-SPAN 2.
C-SPAN 2 and its companion network C-SPAN are the cable television industry's networks for public affairs. If you have a comment about our operations, please write us at the C-SPAN Networks, 400 North Capitol Street, Suite 650, Washington, D.C. Our zip code is 20001.
National Governors Association annual summer meeting, which took place this past week in Tulsa, Oklahoma. The four-day event featured a series of panel discussions focusing on a wide range of issues, including education, healthcare, and international trade. Next, we're going to look back at highlights from the governor's meeting as we begin with the opening session, which took place last Sunday.